Yeah. I like that. Good morning.
Turn it up a little bit.
No, me. I'm turning me up. I like to hear my own voice in my headphones. How you doing? Good morning. It's Mornings with Matt and Bob, powered by Chewy. And we have but one mission. But one mission in life. To get you and to get us through the morning. All right?
All right.
Get you to work a little... in a little better condition than when you left the house. I don't know. We'll try. I can't say. I can't promise we'll deliver, but we'll try. All right? That's all you need to know. Stick with us. Linger longer. As we do today's starting lineups, you know the players taking the field on your behalf. To not only to entertain, but to inform. We call it infotainment. And the man straight ahead. He's the king of infotainment, the hardest working man in show business, ladies and gentlemen. You know what? Yeah. He's not guys out in the ring, but he's a gentle soul. And he takes your phone calls on the fly here. We don't have a screener, so. He also keeps the level straight, does the podcasts, reruns and all that stuff. And there's so many things he does. On his personal life. It's even more dynamic. A shoe head, a food head. There's not a food truck that he hasn't stepped up to, ladies and gentlemen. Please say hello to the incomparable Mr. Chewy El Dorado.
Thank you. Bam. You're right, I am loved.
You are beloved.
I am loved.
Be loved and loved and beloved. Now a man that is loved by many. He's made so many people laugh and brighten their days and nights through stand-up comedy. Through his time on, they used to call it the boob tube.
TV?
Yeah, TV. Back when it used to be an actual tube. A cathode ray tube, a CRT. And, standard definition, albeit.
He was in there?
Yeah. And he came in, it wasn't Fresh Prince or anything like that. It was a show on MTV and then stand-up specials and touring the country, and now he's...
I think I've seen him on Mad TV.
You know, he's a true Texan, and he's settled down here to infotain you every morning, ladies and gentlemen, with Click Click Boom and thick headlines and all that stuff that he does so well. He curates... Ladies and gentlemen, Austin's greatest living storyteller and maybe Austin's greatest newsman. The marvelous Matt Bearden right here.
Thank you, guys. I appreciate that. Smooth sounds. Smooth sounds coming out of his voice. He's laid back today, I can tell. He's in like in a groove. He's in the in groove, if you ask me. Oh, my God. He's actually wearing a shirt that says the in groove. Maybe he smoked a J right before we got in here. He seems very calm today. Chew, doesn't he seem kind of like laid back and calm this morning?
Yeah, a little too calm.
I think it's just called being tired.
Oh, maybe he's just tired. We're getting ready to find out. No wonder he's tired. Think of all the things he's done over the years. He's worked in advertising. He's worked in marketing. He's worked in promotions. He's worked in the film industry. He's worked in the concert industry. Mm-hmm. Is there anything that he hasn't touched when it comes to entertainment? I know he's touched your hearts. Ladies, he's touched some of your bits out there. Oh, that brought a smile to his face as he remembers the old days. Now he's out there just touching the keys, the ones and the twos, and getting it done. Ladies and gentlemen, member of the Texas Radio Hall of Fame and progenitor of Bob Fonseca's Rock and Roll News. It is him, the namesake himself, Mr. Bob Fonseca.
Oh, thank you, man. Thank you. Thank you. Curating that stuff now, too.
See you seem particularly...
No, I'm a ball of nerves and...
Are you?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. It's just all personal stuff. It's all...
Like, you seem particularly mellow this morning.
No.
Okay, then.
No. I mean, I'm glad I'm here with you guys. I mean, this is comforting. This is like, you guys aren't going to come to me with any car problems.
I got texted by
Evan last night. My car won't start. Okay, what am I supposed to do with that information at 10 o'clock at night? You know?
Mm-hmm.
Did you leave something on? I just put a new battery in it. And Caden's car is going kaput, so it looks I'm in the, you know.
Yeah,
I need, you know what I need? This is what I was going to do. I was going to put out the call, and maybe I could cobble together a small salary or something for somebody. I need someone to run my motor pool. You know what I mean?
Like keep them on retainer?
I need someone, yeah. Someone I can keep on retainer that goes, oh, yeah.
Can you add me in there? Because mine's kind of...
Yeah, okay, sure. Sure, I'll add one more.
Put it on the tab. I got you.
And I've got a car that's for sale. I don't have time to market that. It's not easy to sell, you know, a used car. I got to go on, you know, websites and things like that. I guess maybe I should call that John Thomas Clayton, Adam Clayton Powell or whatever.
John Clay Wolf on the weekends?
Yeah.
Give me the VIN?
Yeah, maybe I should just do give me the VIN. Maybe they'll give me a break because we're all in the same station or whatever, but... I need a motor pool guy. I need somebody like to handle all that stuff so I don't have to. It's a waste of time dealing with car issues. Check engine lights, cars that don't start.
Just ignore all that stuff, man.
All Tesla trucks?
We're working toward that.
Oops, all Tesla trucks?
We're working toward that.
Well, you're going to have to work really hard because they're expensive.
Yeah, no. You'd be surprised. Yeah. A three or a used Y, man.
You just said all Tesla trucks.
Trucks.
Oh.
No.
It would be remarkably expensive.
I'm seeing about three or four a day now.
Really?
Yeah, on the street. That's pretty cool.
Man, the neighborhood.
I like them. I'd like to have one.
So you should get one.
Yeah, that'll look really great.
I feel like you must not be seeing...
That would look really great, me rolling up every morning. I told my wife this because she goes, listen, we can make that happen if you want. You deserved it. You've worked your whole life. We could probably make that happen somehow. Sell some stuff off.
Oh, baby, I love you. Let's do it.
No. I say no. What kind of message does that sound when I roll up?
Why are you
in the KLBJ FM parking lot?
Why are you worried about image?
In a Tesla truck.
What kind of image?
Enjoy life.
Right. It does send an image, though.
It sends a message.
Dork.
Yeah. No. I'm not going to do that. I told her I'm not going to do it.
Look,
so
if she moves some money around and she cuts about 2 inches off your dong, I think you'd look great in one of those cars.
I don't know why you guys hate so much.
I'm not hating it. I am saying do it. If I can tell you're serious and you've had this discussion with your wife.
Yeah, as early as last night, but I'm not going to do it. But if there's anybody out there that wants to be a motor pool person for me, like that you have to take 24 hours calls, 24 hours a day. You got to handle all that stuff.
Does Jen have enough money to just buy this behind his back and surprise him?
Mm-hmm. Don't put that out there because people listen.
I'm manifesting.
People upstairs listen and they think that there's something. It's something that's not.
What? People upstairs are a bit like, they think you're less of a man because you have a wealthy wife?
Right. But she's not wealthy. We have no liquid assets whatsoever. And it's frustrating.
Yeah. Look at Chewy and I looking at each other with the same. We're running through the same jokes, man. You can't set us up like that. You can't.
It's so
true. You can't say liquid and assets together.
We're all leveraged. You guys don't understand because you're not in the market or whatever. But you just it's all leveraged.
Oh, that you get that one leg up like that.
It's all stuff that hasn't taxes haven't been paid on it yet, and all that. It's all bizarro land and. But okay,
relax.
Then don't. Will you be my motor pool guy?
I'll help you as much as I can.
What do you know about cars?
And you know what? I got a couple of uncles maybe that could do that.
But you also have to handle the buying and selling too.
That they make.
I've got a couple of beaters that I've got to move. They're not beaters. I mean, they run, but
you seem to sell them for parts.
I don't know what they do. It's all a mystery. All right, enough of mine. I'm not going to talk about my personal life anymore. You guys are
okay. You want to talk about my personal life?
You guys are too mean. Go ahead. What's bugging you? What's bugging you? How can I help?
That was bugging me. I got I got one of those days today.
Did you find the
what is that? Are you masturbating? What's that? The metal detector.
Yeah.
Not
did you
been
find
found.
The metal detector?
Not been
at your
found,
home?
And my child's very worried about it.
Maybe you should get a metal detector.
Last night, I was putting him to bed, and I had completely forgotten about it. It had been over 24 hours,
and it was still on his mind. Huh?
And he said, I just think maybe we should do something about that metal detector. Like as I'm putting him to bed, I'm like, all right, good night. He goes, good night. I just think we should do something about that metal detector. And I was like, oh, this has been eating at you, hasn't it? Dude, I love that dude. I worry sometimes, though, about, you know, how he's wired. And it's like, I'm never going to fully understand how he's wired, right? Because he's made differently than most people. So it's like, I don't have enough experience.
Right.
And, but man, the worry that kid has. And he's so calm about it. Like, he doesn't sit around and shiver. It just is something that rolls through a circle of thought through his head for an entire day. He went and did whatever else he had to do, and
when he came back home, it was probably a reminder. I don't know. You'll find it. It's probably in your storage unit or something.
Yeah. You got to get him to not obsess about things, because that's how he stands in front of someone tied up going, you're supposed to be punished.
Last night, where he burns me the most is he has a pretty good sense of humor. It's different than, you know, us normies.
Are they like
those of us who are programmed properly?
Yeah.
He goes, he wanted some ice cream, and he goes, should I have lime ice cream, which I know are in those little individual cups? Mm-hmm. Or that Dr. Pepper float, Bluebell, it's so good. But that's in a big half gallon. He can't scoop. I don't know why, because his brain works differently. His hands don't work at all when it comes to labor, but
it's hard. Sometimes when that's packed in hard like that, it's hard to...
Okay, don't keep setting us up.
It's hard.
So he goes, should I have lime ice cream or Dr. Pepper ice cream? And I just looked at him and I go, is this a weird way to ask me to scoop the ice cream? He goes, well. And I was like, I did. I'll scoop the ice cream for you. I go. Well, dude, I'm exhausted. I don't think I have the arm strength. I said, arm strength to scoop the ice cream. And I said it with a smile. And he goes, oh, okay. But, you know, he does the literal thing. He walks in. I go, dude, I will, of course, scoop the ice cream for you, dude. Yeah. It's part of my job as a dad is to do those things for you. So scoop the ice cream for him. And then he's putting it away. And I go, hey, man, who's the best dad in the world? And he goes, I guess you? And I go, that's a perfect setup to burn me. Like, what, you could have said something else. You could have said, like, Bob, Milo's Chewy. Dad or something.
Yeah.
And he goes,
yeah, Phil, Uncle Phil.
He goes, yeah, but wouldn't you kind of be expecting, like, that's kind of, those are the jokes you tell on the radio.
Oh, my God. He just accused you of a dad joke.
Damn. He did, dude.
Kind
of. He burned the hell out of me, dude. Wow. I got to go, what, hey, man, what the hell is that supposed to mean?
That's funny.
Man, coming good.
Kids, they say the darndest things.
Well, they do. And I hope he's okay. I made him sleep outside last night. I didn't check on him before he came back in.
Oh, I hope he didn't leave the sprinklers on.
Yeah, no. I hose him down so he's good and wet. And then I just said, enjoy your ice cream. And I locked the doors.
Good.
He's got the mosquitoes to keep him warm.
I stayed up late last night watched, because I don't know why, but Mel Gibson made a movie about a radio talk show host at night.
That was a long time ago, wasn't it?
It's 2022.
Was it?
He's old as hell in it.
Huh. Mel Gibson made a radio talk show host movie?
And some dude takes his family hostage or something like that, and he's on the air with him. Gets kind of intense.
All right.
But I don't think it could be interesting to anyone else except maybe us.
Yeah, right.
And I don't
know why anybody any ideas.
He portrays perfectly. It'll make you cringe. The radio people.
Did anyone decent direct it or something? Does it have anything else going for it?
Mel Gibson? Maybe you've heard of him?
No, I know, but I mean, he directed his own?
Well, I'm assuming he's a talk, some kind of talk host in this movie.
It's called On the Air.
Because nobody takes hostage a guy who's just a disc jockey, right? Introducing, look.
Yeah, he's an a-hole.
Right wing?
No. He's just a talk show host like us and giving advice.
But
he's an a-hole. Like an intern.
So he's like an overnight guy or what? Like, that doesn't even sound like a real radio model.
He is like a late evening guy, but it's like in a big city or something.
Because that doesn't happen.
Your first question, is Online a good movie?
Huh.
I don't know. It's goofy, but yeah.
Let me see. Anybody else we know in it?
On the Line.
Not that I can see.
It's a Netflix movie. We got to start. Let's start watching it. Pull up Netflix on the television.
I haven't seen Roadhouse yet.
I almost started watching it. I mean, I started watching it, but I haven't finished the ending.
I wanted to do a Roadhouse group
rating.
I'll watch Roadhouse again, too.
But how do we do that? My kids know how to do group watches.
Well, we can all just call each other, too, and say, let's start. Ooh.
No, we can literally be on the same screen with the movie and watch it. I know there's a way to do it.
Yeah. Well, but is that really something we want to do?
Well, one of us can pause it when we got to pee. And then it pauses for everybody.
That's my fear. That's my fear that we don't ever get this thing actually watched.
Actually, this would be entertaining to watch together.
Yeah.
Okay. You going to watch the trailer?
Yeah, of course I'm going to watch the trailer.
Okay. Right,
are you really asking me that question?
All right, people. Settle in. Relax. Give me a call. This is On the Line.
Are you ready?
I'm always ready.
We're expecting your calls. Talk to Elvis live on air and tell him about all of your issues
Elvis?
And problems.
That's his name.
Okay, also, it's a Saban film. Do you know who Saban Films is, and do you know how they became wealthy?
No, tell me.
That's the film company that started importing them and voicing the Mighty Morphin Power Rangers.
Really?
Yeah, back in the 90s.
Then I'm a fan.
If it isn't the greatest radio host.
That's one of the...
Yes.
That's what's his name?
Okay, Titus.
From Entourage.
What say you, Gary? Gary, are you with us?
I'm going to do something really screwed up tonight.
You at home?
No.
This is so unreal.
Belong to someone you know?
No.
It belongs there to someone
you know.
There is no... Not very
stop. Why can't you lose stop. Yourself
why,
in fantasy?
Why does the topic... Because there is no, like, regular dude that does an overnight show that has a staff that comes in...
It's producer... It's a call-in show called On the Line.
At midnight. You know what that looks like. You know what a midnight jock looks like.
Stop.
You it's know what it looks city. Like. It's a guy that walks in,
and
he's
soon,
got a key to the building, he works alone.
We're starting to have a big city here, and I think...
And he's built a whole life doing this? Why is he
Chuck
so good?
Might start taking Absolutely calls on metal.
Has, if he's Bob. So good, why isn't he on in prime time?
This is his prime time.
That comes up about, you know,
he's got a wife that
slot.
Fixes his collar before he goes to work, sends him to work. Go get him, honey.
Do you want to watch the rest of this trailer?
No, I don't. This is ridiculous. It's not based in any reality in this business.
I'll be watching
not
it.
In the reality of Mel Gibson would be a good talk
go
show
ahead.
Host.
Here we go.
He got his whole family.
He's got two people on his Gary. Staff.
Well, that's a new guy training.
Hey, Gary, stop. Wait, come on. Why hurt his family? I mean, they're innocent. Better than that, Gary. Tell me calmly. Where exactly are you?
I'm at your house.
Honey.
Tonight, I've gone out of my way to make sure you spend the worst night of your life. See, I've created a game, and I think you're gonna love it.
Oh, there's a bomb, too?
Yeah, I think they're giving away the whole movie, pretty much.
This is just Scream on the radio. Or whatever.
But with Mel Gibson.
And I don't want it to end well.
I don't want to die here.
It's a Speed, right? The movie
yeah,
Speed?
I don't
want to die. It's a lot of movies.
Well, that won't be easy. Now I want you to jump.
So how about you tell us the truth? We're all listening.
Show yourself, you slippery son of a...
Like, bro, it was kind of thrilling.
Dude, somebody just woke up Mel Gibson and like, hey, somebody just streamed the trailer. We might get a viewing.
Is it even a Netflix top 10?
I felt Mel Gibson for a second. In the sense that I wanted to
I
say
looked
something
at that
racist.
And all I had was envy.
Envy?
Better microphone, better mic stand, staff of two people at overnight.
Three, there was a third in there.
Three people on his staff overnight.
I wish you'd focus on the good thing.
Yeah.
It's just not real. That gives people the wrong impression of what radio is.
We have a staff of three people.
No,
we're including us.
It's us, yeah.
Yeah. We're the staff.
His personality is...
I'm listening.
Is what?
It's like a talk show host.
Like us?
I mean, not completely, no.
Does he do live...
Not, like,
let
funny,
me ask you this.
But, like, a-hole.
Let me ask you this. Does he do any live spots?
No.
And if he's so good, does he have good ratings? Do they ever talk about the ratings?
I don't. The ratings. They go into an office and discuss the ratings.
Does it do
overnight?
They're at a plateau.
The overnight ratings.
At a plateau.
Does he? Let me ask you another question. Does he do rock and roll news at any point during this movie?
Bro, it's Mel Gibson. It's gonna be.
Why isn't he on?
Name a bad Mel Gibson movie.
Lethal Weapon 4.
That, I mean, you're just doing that for the, you know.
For what? To answer the question?
The hell
to answer the
you're
question?
You're just doing that to answer the question.
Yeah.
Lethal Weapon 4 is...
Apocalypto?
The Patriot?
Hey, that was good.
Apocalypto was good?
You didn't like it?
I've never seen it. Not enough whites.
Couldn't relate.
Unrelatable, man.
Now, you've already seen Roadhouse.
Yeah, yeah.
Is it worth the watch?
Bro, honestly, Connor did a good job.
Oh, I knew he was going to steal
and
it.
Who would have thought a fire?
Wait, you watched it
fighter.
Already?
Yeah, I had to. The day it came out.
How come we haven't
You still don't buy into my theory of what's coming.
Now I'll watch it again. Your theory is ridiculous.
It's not ridiculous.
I've never heard you have a more ridiculous theory.
MGM owns...
Hang on.
I started thinking about it at the Chili's. And
here's
maybe,
the deal. I want us to discuss that. I want us to discuss your theory, okay?
All right. I think I know a little bit about film. I've been in films.
Everything
I think I know a little more
Avengers.
Than you.
Everything isn't Marvel.
We won another award over the weekend, too, for our movie.
He's hinting. I don't think
well,
I've heard
I haven't seen Roadhouse yet. I've only seen the previews where Jake Gyllenhaal, who I'm not a fan of. I've
had a hard time with him as a movie
I've never
actor.
Gone to a Jake. I've never bought a ticket because Jake Gyllenhaal was in the movie.
Correct.
Now, he might have popped in.
He's actually made some movies worse. I think he made that Spider-Man movie worse.
Yeah. So, I'm not a fan. I have to say that out front.
He's hard to...
I did see the preview where he looks at that guy he's about to kill and he goes,
"I'm about
do you
to
have
kill
good
you.
Insurance?" Remember that?
Yeah, that's the Roadhouse beginning.
Anyway, I have a theory. Since MGM only has two properties.
Okay? What are their properties?
So studios own properties. Sony has Spider-Man. Universal has, I don't know what Universal, they got everybody. You know, Universal has a lot of different franchises and things like that. Of course, we know Disney has Star Wars. They've got Mandalorian. They've got, you know, all the Disney properties, Pixar and all that stuff.
Who has all the DC and Marvel stuff?
That is...
Sony, right?
I know a lot of that's Legendary Pictures, which is a production company. What studio? I don't know. It could be Sony, but I don't think it's Sony.
Might not be. I'm done.
But anyway, MGM has two franchises that they bring. Planet of the Apes comes out. That's Planet of the Apes is 20th Century Fox has Star Wars and Planet of the Apes.
Do anybody think it's weird that Planet of the Apes, when it came out, I was like, oh, I can't believe they're actually redoing one of the Planet of the Apes.
Right.
It was a thing from the 60s that went on a little bit too long.
Yeah.
They're going to actually do like 5 Planet of the Apes movies, aren't they?
I know. They're
all
rebooting
again.
It again. Yeah. Because the technology changes every few years. So, yeah. But MGM has two franchises. They have Roadhouse and they have Creed, the Rockies. They have Rocky and they have Creed.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay.
MGM.
We're with you.
Okay. Dalton's a fighter and Creed's a fighter. Who doesn't see this coming?
Wait.
Doesn't see Dalton versus Creed?
I think he's so dumb until I started thinking about it.
Yeah. You think they're going to have a Dalton versus Creed versus Alien versus Predator kind of thing?
Versus Kong versus Godzilla? Why
That's
not?
That's true. You have all these crossovers, and then you have the crossovers happening in boxing and MMA as well. It would make sense that maybe.
And what else has MGM got going
universe,
for it? What else do they have going for it other than to try to manufacture
That's
some kind
ridiculous.
Of...
That's ridiculous. If they do that, then I'll give up on Hollywood completely.
You'll be what first
if they
in line.
Going pure A24.
What if they have...
Oh, I got A24 news and rock and roll news today. Oh. It's exciting news.
Okay.
Exciting news from A24.
No hint? Okay.
It was just a rumor yesterday, and it looks like this is actually happening.
Oh, my God.
Stop.
Who's going to watch that? Who wants to see?
Stop. We're talking about Creed. Who gets top billing? I think it's Creed versus Dalton.
In my mind and culture, it's Dalton.
But what if they spread it out? Because this is MGM. MGM has the MGM Grand. MGM Grand is where they've had so many legendary boxing fights right. over the years. What if they end up hosting the Logan Paul... Mike Tyson fight.
Mm-hmm.
I forget where that's
and then go. And then they end up casting both of those, and Mike Tyson goes into the next Roadhouse movie, And Logan Paul is in the next Roadhouse movie.
I'm telling you.
That's where I think the possibilities are endless. Will be easier to go, is the sequel will have celebrities in it and fighters.
Right.
That you'll recognize.
Well, just remember, I just want you to remember you heard it here first. I'm not going to put it in prediction corner. I think it's a no-brainer.
I think it's still kind of a long shot, but I think it's possible.
I mean, MGM, those guys have got to be sitting around in the boardroom going, well, what do we do next? First of all, Roadhouse went straight to Netflix.
Well, no, didn't go straight to Netflix. That's who paid for it.
Yeah, no, I know that, but then that was the contract. I did that story. That was the contract. The director was all bent out of shape that it didn't get a theatrical because he thought that Jake Gyllenhaal would have been up for some kind of acting award, which is laughable. But Netflix had to remind the director of the movie, like, you got the big budget for this movie. You got a bigger budget.
This movie got made because we were desperate for content.
Right.
Because nobody would have put this budget. No one was going to take a chance of putting this in the theaters.
And Netflix told them, if you want to go in the theaters, we'll give you less of a budget to make the movie. So they took the big budget Netflix option, and now they were trying to backtrack on it. I'm glad we don't work in Hollywood. It's weirder than radio.
It's real. It's nasty.
It's nasty, right?
Yeah.
That guy, that the director would try to go back on the deal and try to get a theatrical run.
But Netflix is the
one. When he got the budget that he wanted.
I don't know.
I got big movie news, man. I can't wait. How many minutes? I've got like 8 minutes before I can.
Before you can tell us about that Bruce Springsteen thing?
Now, Matt.
Didn't we mention that already?
That was a pipe dream. That was a pipe dream.
You must have sucked pretty hard on that pipe.
Now I've got all the facts.
You squeezed the balls, too,
all the facts.
It is already here.
I've got all the facts now.
Just the facts.
And just speculation yesterday. But we did some deep... My team did some deep research.
Yeah.
So, anyway, that's enough of that. Don't give away my... You want to tell them the other stories that I'm going to do?
I didn't tell anybody anything. I made a comment, then you started into it. You could have just said, I don't know what you're talking about.
I did a big tease.
Well, you're not a good spy. Can I tell you that? If I were to bring up one thing and you were to go, oh, man. You know what I'm saying?
I'm Rock's last great reporter. I don't know what you're talking about.
How is your poker face? I was thinking about having another poker game because I had a successful one the other night.
I hate playing poker with guys in it. I hate poker parties.
Why?
I don't know.
How's your O-face?
What are we really doing?
We're gambling
quarters,
for money.
Bringing a roll of quarters to a, you know.
I don't know who you play with, but yeah, that's right.
What are you putting? How much are you putting up?
I mean, a regular pot will be, you know. A
couple hundred?
Yeah. A person?
I mean, no, not a person.
Everybody brings like 100, 200 bucks to a
poker
game. I mean,
at least bring about 50 bucks, you know, if you want to limp in a few hands.
I don't know.
But at least bring a hundred.
I mean, if it was everybody, I don't like playing with strangers. Like, I don't, you know, when you go to somebody's house and then there's some couple dudes you don't even know, loose cannons you don't even know. You know, why are they here? How did they crash our...
They know somebody and it's extra money for me to win. And it's better with a stranger because then I'll tell my friend later, hey man, I'm drunk.
Can I
give me my money back?
Can I come to the party but have someone play for me?
No.
I can bring my own player?
No, that is not fair. A proxy? No.
Well, you got a lot of rules. It's your poker party.
It's not. Oh, here, my one rule. Please
Are you going to make Monte Cristos for everybody?
That's the one that's deep fried?
Yeah, it's a fried sandwich with some. Is that the one that has jelly in it?
I feel like
a croque monsieur?
I feel like the host has to have a great sandwich. If you're going to throw a poker party,
we'll get one of those.
I don't know because I was watching.
The big 6 foot sandwiches.
Do you know where the sandwich, the Earl of Sandwich, was busy with a card game and didn't want to get up from his seat?
And
he asked somebody, bring me food, and they put meat in between bread.
Yeah.
And that's how the sandwich was invented.
Yeah.
We have an Earl of Sandwich.
No, you can't get a 6 foot sub because I know what you'll do.
What?
You'll
go Earl of Manwich.
You'll go after the show. You'll get a 6 foot sub at like 11 in the morning. It's going to sit because you can't put it in the refrigerator. Because it's too big. It's going to sit on your shelf for like 10 hours before the poker party. We're all going to get sick.
Okay, so don't eat the sandwich. We'll have salad, too.
Salad?
I want you to make...
You can't eat a salad at a poker game.
You don't
game.
Make friends with salad.
I want you to make fresh, either a Monte Cristo or... What's another... What's the sandwich you said?
The croque monsieur?
Yeah.
You're going to get club sandwich.
Some pedophores or something.
Cut in triangles. That's it.
I want those... finger sandwiches, you know, that have like a cucumber and cream cheese.
With the like crust the lady, cut off?
Yeah, that ladies have
they're
whenever they have.
Aren't they?
I don't know what they're called.
What?
The little tiny sandwiches.
Finger sandwiches.
That you have when you go to, like when ladies have some kind of.
Pedophores.
I think they're called pedophores.
Yeah.
Hang on a second. Hang on.
When is this party? Because I'm kind of
booked. You got some pedos there?
But it's Betty.
Oh, petit four.
Yeah, he just doesn't know how to say it.
Okay. A pedophore is a small, bite-sized confection or savory appetizer.
That's what a pet. What is a pedophore?
Translates to small oven. But those are little candies, pretty much. Those little square cakes that are like that, an inch square.
How do you feel about paninis?
Are you making them fresh?
Yeah, I'll press them right there on the table.
You press your panini up against them?
At Jersey Mike's, they slice it fresh.
We press it fresh.
We press it fresh.
Idiotic. Stupid.
I would do it if it's you. Well, now see.
And I'll do it here.
But Spencer and I can't be in the same room. I don't know why he hates me.
And it'll be nice because you can win your shoe money back from him.
Oh, that'll help. That'll help our relationship when I win Spencer's money. That'll help our friendship, or lack thereof.
Here's the thing. If you win money from Spencer, know that you're taking literally everything he has.
Can we smoke cigars?
No. What is it, 1973?
Have you not seen The Odd Couple? I was in The Odd Couple in high school.
Did you just smoke
cigars?
Did you just ask a guy who was born in 1990 if he has not seen a show that left the air in the 60s?
The movie or the play? The Neil Simon play?
I've only read the book.
Yeah. Have you not seen the movie that was in theaters in 1967? Come on, Chewie.
It's a classic.
Yeah. Here's the thing.
The Odd Couple is a classic.
Are you ready for my theory?
Yeah.
Oscar Madison...
Versus
Creed versus Dylan. What do you think?
I like it.
I like it. That sounds like a lame poker party to me if we can't smoke cigars and drink.
You don't even smoke cigars, and I don't even think you could take a puff of a cigar. That's crazy.
In the day, I used to be down Cedar Street every weekend smoking cigars and drinking chocolate martinis.
God, dude.
I have a feeling.
That was Austin circa 1995.
It was terrible.
I know it was terrible. It was cringe. You had to wait in line to do it.
And dudes decided they were all cigar experts.
Yeah.
And it's just weird to see men all like sucking on a sausage and drinking out of a big fancy glass. I was like, what's going on with this
and
city?
And you waited in line. You stood in line for the privilege do that.
Is Cedar Street to blame for everything, for the direction that Austin ended up heading
in? And a couple other places in West Austin, West 6th.
I think it's just Cedar Street that started the whole damn thing.
What was that little narrow shotgun bar that was on West 6th?
Narrow shotgun bar.
Yeah, right on a corner.
On West 6th?
I'll think about it.
Dogwood?
No.
Maybe there's like three of them, right?
Or Jay Black's?
No, it's in
that
area.
That wasn't narrow. Hey, here's the thing, too. All the guys at that time had these weird shirts, okay? And here's the deal.
Y'all romanticize it. I don't think I would have liked it.
Are you ready? No, dude, it wasn't. I used to go in the back door.
And everybody knew everybody.
Because I knew staff there. So you'd skip the line because the comics would skip the line. And then they would just give us some free drinks that were spills. Yeah. But all the dudes that were hanging out smoking their big cigars and... wore these dress shirts, and are you ready? It'd be like, it would look like this. It'd have one pattern, and then they would roll their cuff, and on the other side of the cuff, there'd be another pattern of material
That was like a Robert Graham shirt.
Is that 02?
Yeah.
No, this has been
that
like
was a
96,
shirt you could get it,
97, 98, probably.
At Joskies or whatever, at Dillard's or whatever. Robert Graham.
Yeah.
And then the inside of the collar would have that paisley print. Yeah, or sometimes inside the button, You know, the placket? Be covered, it would be covered up, but if you opened your shirt, you could see the strip of paisley print.
Oh, God.
I never had one of those, but that was, I think Robert Graham was the brand.
It was a bit, and that was just like, that was all the dudes hanging out, smoking their cigars.
And drinking chocolate martini.
It looked so weird because the dudes were all essentially wearing matching shirts. I mean, it was,
yeah,
and it was a uniform. Different colors, but yeah, but there was like a uniform to get up and a huge line. And then in the back, they, we all know the door guy. So if you were comics, you just slid in. Mm-hmm. God, that place.
What was the funk band that used to play there that we?
I don't know.
They played some of our parties.
Yes, no, I know.
They played some of our parties in the old days.
Something with Junction.
Yeah, Dysfunction Junction.
Dysfunction Junction.
Would be on stage throwing down some cool in the gang.
But there was a funk with a K, right?
Yeah.
I like it.
Yeah. Those were the days.
Even Mick Jagger embarrasses his kids.
I report the news. That's what I do.
He's Bob Fonseca's Rock and Roll News.
Ow! That's right, Mr. Announcer Man. You get that name right. He did pronounce it right. Thank you. It is time for the rock and roll news. It is Thursday, March 28th. I have all the headlines you need and more. Now, pardon me. Excuse me. Pardon my French. But it's going to be a little scattered today because I've got stories on my talking machine, on my laptop, in my head. Stories are coming in left and right. All the some of the facts are changing as, you know, I'm going to do the best I can to bring you all the current headlines. So you don't look like a doofus when you go to work today. You're going to have all the headlines that you need to know. You're going to impress your coworkers, your family. All right? You're not going to embarrass your kids like Mick Jagger did. You know what, man. Matt? I felt a little bit better for guys like you and me.
Did you?
Who are constantly embarrassing our kids. Who knew that even the great Mick Jagger is capable of doing the same thing?
Well, I've seen Mick on stage, so... Remember that period where he was wearing the football pants and he was doing the extra bird walk?
Yeah.
It was not his greatest look.
Mm. Mm. Yeah.
He did that, though.
He did that in Philadelphia, I think. Mick Jagger's son, Lucas Jagger, trolls him after Mick posted a clip of himself dancing wildly in a bar. It made me laugh a little bit because it showed up on my feed. Yesterday, I follow Mick Jagger. I suggest you do the same. He likes to go to clubs kind of incognito or you know, public bars with a baseball hat on and not get recognized.
Huh.
You know?
Yeah.
And then shoot video of himself drinking or dancing, you know, with nobody even paying him any attention. Which has got to be great for him.
Yeah, that's a good change up.
Yeah, it's a change, right? Because he is Mick Jagger, one of the greatest rock. He's still out there. They're going on tour, you know. Do you know that?
Mm-mm.
We're going to do a show trip. We're going to go to a Stone show. Ain't no show like a Stone show.
Never.
Is this before or after our Vegas trip?
I don't know. We got to get our calendars out. We got to get our
September 27th.
Get your Palm Pilots out. We'll do it later today.
I'll look for other shows, too.
All right, here we go. Even Mick Jagger's kids are embarrassed by their dad sometimes. The 80-year-old.
Damn.
Rolling Stone singer.
He isn't running for president?
That's a good question, Matt. Good question,
thank you.
Oh, he's not a U.S. citizen. There's some rule.
Do we really care about the rules to the presidency anymore?
Arnold Schwarzenegger probably wishes that rule wasn't in place, but it is a rule. You have to be a U.S. citizen. You don't have to be born here, but you have to be a citizen, I think. The 80-year-old Rolling Stone singer shared a new video on Instagram yesterday showing him dancing to a live band at a club. In the clip, Jagger dances while making funny faces directly to the camera or the phone or whatever and grabbing his crotch.
That's rock and roll.
He captions the clip. This is Mick's own caption. Moves like who?
Ooh.
Referring to Maroon 5's 2010 hit. Has it been that long?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know what? That song sounds as good today as it did in 2010. Mm-hmm. Maroon 5's coming to, they're going to Vegas. They're going to be at,
Adam's my guy,
they're going to be at the Dolby Live theater.
Adam.
I'd like this.
The way
And then Lucas Jagger commented up on his dad's post saying, quote, Dada, who put you up to this? So,
Oh, Maroon 5's
how great would that be to be Mick Jagger's kid?
I guess money-wise, it'd be pretty awesome.
Mm-hmm. I think it would be pretty awesome.
I think also private plane-wise, it'd be pretty awesome.
Yeah, swimming pool.
I feel like morning foot rubs, it's going to be pretty awesome.
Yeah.
Private chef, awesome.
I wonder if he's a musician or if he's in the music. And I can't tell by looking at him how old he is. He looks like he's maybe mid-20s.
No, he's not mid-20s. It wasn't that late that he had him, right?
Well, oh how many times has Mick been married? He was married to
almost
Bianca
Jagger. Almost as many as you.
Now, Matt.
Matt.
This is the part of the show where we do rock and roll news, and you're supposed to lift me up because I'm rock's last great reporter.
Oh, is this the 20 minutes where we pretend to respect you?
I am untouchable.
Okay, I'm sorry. I forgot.
In this segment.
He didn't know.
I'm not sure because how many times he's been married, Rock God. How many times do you think he's been married?
I don't know. This is a lot. Stop it. All right, one of the most interesting historical stories in the history of rock and roll is the story of George Harrison, Eric Clapton, and Patty Boyd. That love triangle. Now, Patty Boyd was George Harrison's girlfriend way back in the day. George Harrison of the Beatles, of course, the quiet one, the spiritual one. And then he married Patty Boyd. And then, somewhere along the way, George Harrison's best friend, Eric Clapton, who, by the way, he brought in to play guitar on While My Guitar Gently Weeps on the White Album.
As he should have.
One of the few rock musicians to play on a Beatles record. Eric said, hey, mate.
Hey, mate.
Let me try to do an Eric Clapton impression.
Hello, mate. Hello, mate. Hello, hello, hello. How would you like... If you were to give me your wife, and I was to marry her, because I really love her, and I'll trade you a guitar or something for... I don't know what went down, but George took the offer, and Patty ended up with Eric Clapton, slow hand. He might have had a slow hand, but he was quick on the...
It's not what I heard.
Anyway, that's where the song Layla came from. Layla's about Patty Boyd. Now, here's the story, though.
It's got to upset Patty, though, that he called her the wrong name for an entire song.
Well, that's what you do in literature. Sometimes you... In my book, you're going to have a different name.
So
I can say the things about you I really want to say that I can't say to you.
So if I'm having sex with my wife and I call out the wrong name, I just tell her, honey, it's literature.
It's creative license.
What I'm doing right now is literature.
It's creative license.
Stop being so angry. I'm a book writer, honey.
So Patty Boyd is still alive, obviously. She owned the original painting that is the cover of the album Layla by Derek and the Dominoes, Eric Clapton's band.
Mm-hmm.
And she just sold it at auction. How old is she now? Still looking okay. The painting is called... It's a French painting. It's called Les Jeunes Filles à Bouquet. I think it means the young lady in the flowers or something. Anyway, it was created by Emily Theodore Franson in the mid-50s. It was the cover to Layla. And she had this painting. It's a big piece. It's a big painting. She sold it for $2.5 million. So I guess she has the last laugh. You know? Her whole collection was part of a whole collection. It included letters, photos, and more from her relationships with the two musicians. Had love letters from Eric Clapton that were in there.
I'll put that in the museum.
Could you imagine your best friend...
Mm-mm.
Coveting your wife or your girlfriend.
Mm-mm.
But that's the way it was back in the 60s in rock and roll. Anything went. You
Man,
know,
that's cool.
You know?
I mean, it's kind of getting back to that.
You think?
Yeah.
Yeah. Anyway, they divorced. Clapton and Patty Boyd divorced in 1977. Boyd met Harrison. She was an extra, I believe, on the film Hard Day, which was shot in 1964. So this sounds like a story that they should, if they haven't already, someone should make a movie out of. That's
I mean, look at the star power you got. You got George Harrison, Eric Clapton, Hard Day's Night. You got the Beatles.
Too many movies being made.
You got Patty Boyd. You got all this stuff.
Pace yourself.
Know? Yeah. We're going to talk about movies next. All right.
Know.
Now the big rock and roll news. Now, yesterday, this reporter hinted, because I was seeing some rumblings in Hollywood that there was some scuttlebutt about...
Scuttlebutt?
There was some scuttlebutt about Jeremy Allen White, the star of the handsome, curly-haired star...
The
of,
Bear?
Of Bear. Of the Bear.
Lip?
And there was some speculation that he was going to play Bruce Springsteen in a movie. Now, sometimes in Hollywood, those things happen because someone snaps a paparazzi... snaps a picture of a star, and then someone goes, ooh, that he looks a little like so-and-so.
Right.
Maybe they should make a movie. Maybe Adam Driver should be Joey Ramone.
Sure.
That went around forever. Never happened. But it looks like it's all true. It looks like it's coming to be, and it looks like we have a green light in the future for the first ever Springsteen narrative biopic. And the reason I say it's going to happen what? Is because I know the book that they're going to base it on. I'm reading it currently. I bought it a couple months ago. It's called, it's a book about the making of Nebraska called, I'll give you the title in a second.
Okay.
I can't think of it. I got a lot of facts flowing on it. The former programming head of Netflix, who left Netflix last year, I believe, is show running this project. And it's going to be his first project since leaving Netflix. The film about Springsteen that Jeremy Allen White is going to star as the boss is specifically going to hone in on his Nebraska period.
Now, does this frighten you? Like, you love both these guys so much.
I love this album. It's my favorite Bruce album.
Aren't the stakes too high?
No.
No.
Deliver Me From Nowhere is the book, which is a book about the making of Nebraska. Now, I don't know, Chewy, if you know this. I know this. Nebraska was an album that never was supposed to be released, and it's one of Bruce's greatest.
Really?
He recorded demos on a four-track cassette, on a TAC four-track, may have been a Tascam.
Why do
four-track
artists...
cassette deck. And he carried that thing around on the beach in his back pocket for months and months and months. A cassette. And his producer said, hey, this is pretty good. You need to release this as is. As it is, on the cassette. And so Bruce turned over this dirty cassette with a handwritten label over to the record label, and they released the album. With no accoutrement, no overdubs or anything. What you see, and some credit that is starting the whole kind of indie rock movement. Where it was okay to release your demo tapes or your weird stuff.
What is
they
it
created
about?
A whole. There probably wouldn't be a Wilco if Bruce, and I think Jeff Tweedy has said that, wouldn't be a Wilco if Nebraska had never been released.
It is like that song Highway Patrolman. It's pretty haunting, all yeah. stripped down the way it is.
A Mansion on the Hill. How about that one? How about Atlantic City, which the band covered later? Anyway. It looks like this film is going to happen. I cannot wait to see how they're going to do this. Do you think that... I think it's going to happen. I don't see you guys having any interest or any enthusiasm
it's not that
for this
project.
I don't know why I bring you this insight.
You're talking. What are we supposed to do?
Not only did I bring you news about Eric Clapton and Bruce Springsteen, but I put it into... historical context that no one else at this station could do. Not even Andy Langer or Jody or whoever could have put it in the historical context that I put it in for you. And
we were supposed to interrupt that?
And, huh?
I don't know.
And I get nothing back. I get like, oh, Bob, thanks for, thanks for informing us.
Getting yelled at for reason in the morning is really bringing back some memories.
How delightful.
I was going to say, what is it with artists that hate their best work, what we consider their best work?
They can't see. They can't see themselves for themselves.
Things that they wouldn't have released, or things that just they're just like, I hate that song.
When you think about, like, in the case of Brent, I hate to talk about Bruce, but it's just on top of my mind because I went to the show last week.
I don't think you hate talking about Bruce.
He didn't even want to.
No part of me feels like you.
He didn't even want to put Hungry Heart on the river. He wanted it off the album.
Well, it should have not have been on the album.
He didn't think
it's not a very good song.
Well, guess what his biggest commercial hit was?
Okay. I don't know.
Hungry Heart.
All right, Mel Tillis.
I got you good. I got you good with an insult that only you got and nobody else got.
You bring up an interesting point that sometimes artists are self-defeating.
Good question.
If I can use that. It was a good thought.
All right.
And thank you for playing along, unlike this shaloub.
How am I not playing along? I said, how does it work? Are you worried? I'm asking you questions. I'm staying involved. It's just that after you read it, what else was I supposed to do? You're the one that spoiled the surprise yesterday.
That was conjecture and rumor yesterday. But now we know it to be true. It's going to happen. And I think with the people involved, the book that they're basing it on, and the showrunner and all that, that it's, I would say, I'm going to go ahead and put that in prediction corner.
How many months until Bob comes in here going, yes, band. Yes, band.
Yes, band.
Yes, boss.
That's cool.
That's cool.
That's cool, man. That's
cool. You're cool, Bob.
That's cool. Let's see. Sheryl Crow says Spotify payments make her sad and sick. Well, your music does the same for me.
Wow. Wow.
Oh, wow. Come on, bro. Are you team?
Come on. Yeah. Come on.
Come on.
If Michael Che had done that on Weekend Update, you go, oh, geez, Michael Che is brilliant. That's
yeah,
so funny.
Yeah, SNL's really going downhill. Yeah.
He's cool, though. Michael Che's cool.
No, I have nothing against Sheryl Crow. I'm sorry. Except one time I heard her do an interview with Howard Stern, and she said people should only use one sheet of toilet paper.
I'm okay with that.
To take care of their business. They're not eating right. If she implied that we're not eating right. If you have to use more than one sheet of toilet paper, you're doing something wrong with your diet.
I agree with you. I think the sheets should be bigger and longer.
I think you would need about 10 ply. Well, your finger's going to go right through, man.
Give me a paper towel roll.
Let's see.
Well,
what
if
else?
It makes you crappy.
Grateful Dead, who I'm not a huge fan of.
Most reporters don't immediately let people know how they feel about stuff right up front.
I know, I do. I don't get it. It's not for me. It wasn't created for me. I'm not their target audience. Got to be stoned out of your gourd to love the Grateful Dead. Their songs go on and on and on, and it's like,
it seems like they're repeating.
It's not like the succinct
yes, right.
30-second concerts that Bruce Springsteen puts on, right? How long is Jungle Land?
Yeah, but he plays 29 songs. A Grateful Dead 3-hour concert could be 2 songs.
Oh, so in Vegas, he
played
for you.
In Vegas, he played for 2 hours and 55 minutes. Because I put the stopwatch.
It just seems like you hate your audience at that point. It seems like you hate your audience.
Not one person left, and I stood. We all stood the whole time. Even the people on the floor, we stood.
Well, of course you did.
Whole time.
Nobody in that audience.
Why do you hate Bruce so much?
Yeah.
What has he done to you?
What did he do to you?
No, I'm just saying.
It's hard for anybody
in that. With the prostates in that audience, it's not like they can pee that fast. So they're going to be able to hang out for 3 hours anyway.
I did relieve myself during the rising. I had to make a choice.
Right there where he stood.
It was about an hour and a half into the show, and I go, okay, I know the big encores are coming. The big hits are coming. What song am I going to duck out on? And I have nothing against The Rising, because that's like his 9/11 song.
Yeah.
But I've heard it so many times, I'm like, okay.
How many guys were in the bathroom trying to get a stream
started?
There was a line
to get in during The Rising.
How long was the line to get into the women's room?
Come on up to The Rising.
How long was the line to get in the women's room during the Bruce Springsteen show?
Oh, no, no line. Nobody left. Nobody.
I'm going to walk around and sell salon puffs.
Grateful Dead announced a 50th anniversary edition of Mars Hotel, their classic album. I know it's a classic album cover. What great songs were on...
All of them.
I don't think so.
All of them.
Let's see. Ship of Fools, China Doll, Wave That Flag. I don't know. I don't know the album. I know the album cover. It's very spacey and airbrushy, and it's got some weird writing on there. Anyway, their 50th anniversary of that is coming out. It's going to be on multiple discs, bonus track. You know the drill. $100, probably. Three discs.
Probably.
You know, on black vinyl, as it should be. Oh, and limited edition neon pink vinyl, too.
Time for Rock and Roll News, Junior. The Rock!
Bear with me, because I've got to find the... Rock and Roll News, Junior, the headlines for the kids on the way to the dropout zone right now. They need Rock and Roll News to keep them motivated in school so they can do their homework, read lots of books, and join a band, start a band. Play real loud. You don't have to be good. Put it on 11. You're the future of rock and roll. Let's see. Michael Sparling is one of my stringers. Thank you, Michael. He sent me this. Now the kids love 21 Pilots, don't they? Don't they?
I think so.
Huh? What are some of their big hits, Chewy?
You got the...
They're going to kick off their world tour in Las Vegas.
What?
And tickets are going to go on sale April 5th. So, kids, get your parents.
Just tell fly them, you out to Vegas?
Yeah. Just make sure your kids are off the street by like 9 p.m.
Why?
I don't know. Then a lot of literature comes out that on the ground and the cards and things with images.
Kids love reading.
I know. It's called the Clancy World Tour. I don't know what that refers to because I'm not a 21 Pilots fan, but you kids out there on the way to the dropout zone,
In fact, there's one pilot that you really hate.
Who's that?
Your brother.
Oh, yeah.
He's so much more successful than you.
We're not talking right now.
21 Pilots hit Stressed Out from 2015. Mm.
If I could turn back time to the good old days.
9 years?
Yeah, I'm feeling it's longer than 9 years ago.
All right, it's time for the Rock and Roll News Salute, and this one goes to... here we go. Oh, this is nice. This is from Jamie. Jamie Coralejo. How do you pronounce? C-O-R-R-A-L-E-G-E-J-O. Coralejo? Yeah, let's say that. But there's an A in there. Coralejo. Anyway, he writes to me at bobsrocknews@gmail.com. Shout out to my daughter, Janelle. It's her birthday, and we're about to celebrate her quinceañera.
Janelle!
This
happy
Saturday. We listen from New Braunfels. Now, imagine that. They listen to Rock and Roll News all the way up in New Braunfels.
Are y'all doing a crazy quinceañera choreographed dance like I've been seeing online?
Every day. They listen from New Braunfels. Even though she listens for just 10 minutes, thanks to you guys, now my other daughter, who's 9, likes to listen to the show, too. She learns new words, words from you guys every day. And he put one of those crying, sweating, smiling faces. So, happy quinceañera, Janelle. Thank you for listening to us and the Rock and Roll News. This is for you, and I hope you have a great party, and they pin a lot of $20 bills on you.
You're a woman now.
Is that what they do?
In Arkansas.
Do they pin money?
I don't know.
At a quinceañera?
Or am I thinking, is that a wedding?
That's a dollar dance.
How do you get your money at a quinceañera? In an envelope?
You gotta steal it.
Hey, rock and roll saved my life. I know it can save yours. Thanks for bearing with me. I hope you enjoyed the history lesson. You know, I'm here to not only give you the news, but put it in context, unlike those idiots on Fox. You know what I mean? I put it in historical context for you. I'll do it again tomorrow. It'll be the last installment of the week. Right now, though, I have to tell you about... Hey, Mornings with Matt and Bob, powered by Chewy. We're on your radio every morning, Monday through Friday at this time. And then you can catch us in our social medias, Matt and Bob FM, on the Instagram. And then you can catch replays of the show at klbjfm.com, which you should check in regularly and check the concert schedules and stuff like that. And then we go out into the GP, as they say, the general public, occasionally, as we're going to do on 420. April 20th, this show will take the stage at 800 Congress. It's kind of catacorner from the Paramount Theater.
Mm.
It's a venue that they use for Moon Tower Comedy, and we're part of the Moon Tower Comedy Fest 2024. We're going to do what we call a podcast, though that's kind of a misnomer.
It's just a little live show.
It's a live show, a variety show. Remember the old movies of the videos of the Rat Pack in Las Vegas with just hamming it up on stage? That's pretty much what we do. Well, we talk about things. We have guests, and we'll have comedy guests, and, you know, we want to pack it with as many friendlies, familiar faces as we can. Tickets are going to be $20. I think it's austintheater.org.
Yeah, are they available? I got to tell you what.
When I was on yesterday, it looked like they were available.
When I think about Moon Tower, when I think about anything comedy right now, April has me on the edge of a panic attack every day.
Yeah.
I don't know. There's just stuff going on. I have family members I'm neglecting.
They used to call it a nervous breakdown back in the 50s. They don't call that. They don't call it that anymore, I don't think.
I really do. I mean, right now, even the feeling that I'm having, just you talking about it. What's going on with my brain?
Yeah, because we were looking forward to this.
I'm in an absolute panic mode.
I think it's that Eddie Gosling thing. I know you're going to be opening.
It's not just that. I just feel like there's so much happening. Like the week of April 11th, 10th, 11th, and 12th, all three of those nights, I'm out and we have events.
Yep.
I've got a show the 10th. The 11th is that women in media gala. The 12th, I'm judging a talent contest at a middle school. Then we have that full weekend.
You're in demand.
There's too much happening along with constant 12-hour days.
You better be unbiased in that talent show, too.
I will be. That's the one thing I'm good at.
You should be happy that you're still viable and in demand.
I don't know. I do not enjoy the level of stress I'm currently dealing with.
Well, if you want to get tickets to see Matt being stressed out, austintheater.org. And, by the way, they spell theater the old-fashioned way with the E after the R.
I like that one.
I do, too, because it's a little more classy.
It is.
Because I don't want to be in a theater. I want to be in a
It's like
theater.
color with the U.
It's like theater.
Now, what are we going to do during this? What are we going to do this year? Are we going to do something similar to last year? Are we going to transform into some kind of brand new stage show? We haven't even had a discussion about
we
it.
We roll out a projector and play last year's.
We didn't film last year yet.
Oh, man.
We had, who do we have on the docket that day? We had
Daniel Van Kirk.
Daniel Van Kirk, DBK.
Shane. I'll think of his. Why am I? This is. See this kind
Shane,
of stress.
Just
I'm
say
under?
Shane. Uh-huh. Funny
Torres.
Man Shane.
Torres. Thank you. Shane Torres and Avery Moore.
So we're going to have some guests.
We should have this one a little more smoke centric or something.
Yeah, because it is 420.
It's 420,
and
right?
The show starts at 420
on
and
Saturday?
On 420.
Sorry. We got to do something.
I might even puff.
No.
On a daddy. Or whatever.
We couldn't have you do that.
Did you just say you might puff on a daddy?
Whatever you kids say, I don't.
Are you aware of what's in the news? What's going on?
Do you
on
know about
I
all the stories
know.
About what Diddy has had other men do for him?
And you're going to puff on a daddy?
I'm rock and roll news.
It's very uncomfortable right
news.
Now. Very uncomfortable.
We'll puff on a J or whatever.
Which, by the way,
I don't know.
Between Puff Daddy, the Disney documentaries, and Dateline, just all of, like, I would not want to be a kid. It seems like just everybody wants to.
Yeah. They want to ruin everything.
Kids, protect
anyway,
yourself at all times.
You can go to austintheater.org. Tickets are only $20, which I think is a bargain in this day and age. If you can go see anything for under $20, $20 or under, you're winning, right?
Yeah.
And we give you a good 90 minutes to a couple hour. I mean, it just all depends on how we're rolling.
Are there like CBD dabs?
I don't understand that question. Would you translate that for me, Matt?
CBD concentrates?
Yeah, you ever done dabs?
No, I don't know what the dab. A dab is a handshake.
You ever?
That's a dab.
You ever done glass?
Oh.
Some shatter? You ever enjoyed a little shatter?
Crumble. I'm fond of crumble myself.
Shake. I've done some shake.
Okay. you ever roll up some seeds?
We've got to find a way we can smoke. I don't know.
How about this? Just start smoking.
No, I don't want to get the show. I don't care about myself, but
I don't think a cop's
going to
sit
trouble.
Through our show, do you?
I don't think anyone's going to sit through our show.
We have a lot of cop fans. You know how many policemen have approached me, and I've been scared, and they're like, hey, man.
Right, but don't you think...
Big fan of the show, love the show.
And that's why I think we'll be protected a little bit.
There's some cool police officers.
Who's gonna do it first?
Nobody,
who's gonna light up first?
Nobody has any problems with the cool police officers. It's the police officers that from time to time get a little uncool that I think is where the issue is. Do you know what I mean?
That's when they're in groups and then one of them is a bad influence. Just like gangs. Now, can I smoke a CBD joint maybe in the...
Is that a thing?
Remember that...
Yeah, they got CBD joints.
Adam Raposa right now got arrested, but they don't know what to do with him because he's like... Everything that you took from me is CBD. Can't you just play the same card and just say... I mean, they essentially decriminalized weed in the city, right? Now it's just a ticketable offense? You're not willing to just get a ticket for the team?
I guess at the most we get a ticket. And will the company pay for that?
Here's the thing. How about this? I want you to put an edible in a pipe and light it and smoke it. Mm. I want you to smoke an edible.
Mm. Hey, do you think...
What?
Do you think Rachel Feinstein will come on with us?
Yeah, if you learn to pronounce her name.
Feinstein? Mm-hmm. Feinstein?
No, it's Raquel.
Todd Barry's be in. How come our name's not on the poster? And if it was, where would it be? What size
type? Well, I told you that seems to be an issue. I noticed that we were listed in the KLBJ podcast.
I don't care if it's
to be the biggest, but
look, Sawyer Stull is on the last line. And it's tiny. I have to get my spectacles out to see, but I wouldn't mind being down there in the last line with Sawyer, but I don't see Matt and Bob anywhere.
We're not on the poster right now.
Okay.
And that's why I was saying earlier, like, I feel like, I don't know if we've miscommunicated or what, but it's being a little also-ran. A little sad.
Here it is, Matt and Bob. 420 with Matt and Bob. 800 Congress, Saturday, April 12th, 4:20 p.m. So we're definitely on the site.
Okay.
They don't have our cool graphic up yet, but clear bag policy.
Sweet. That way we can see your weed.
Anyway, you can get tickets now.
Yeah, Ziploc bags are clear.
I think we should probably start the show at 4:25.
Yeah.
Anyway, technically speaking,
it would give us a lot of confidence.
It depends on the venue. What's the place where they let you can smoke on the roof? Not Flamingo Lounge, something.
The Flamingo Cantina? I mean that place exists, but
oh. Am I out? There's some places that you just smoke and it's known.
You mean every place in the city of Austin?
No, but like, I mean,
I haven't been anywhere in 5 years where people just aren't smoking out in the open. Like since COVID, people are just like, yeah, I'm just
weed?
Smoke. Yes.
Joints.
Yes.
Blunts.
Yes.
Spliffs.
Yes. You out of terms?
I can't think of anything.
That's disappointing. Duchies. You're out of terms already.
A duchy. Come on, that's my favorite.
Boy. Lean in now for some... Damn, boy, he's thick. Boy, that's a thick-ass boy. Thick headline.
It is 8 o'clock. It's time to get into those Austin area headlines. And congratulations, Austin. I mean, Texas in general. But no congratulations to Austin. We didn't make the list. Some very weird searches are hitting Google right now. Google released a list of the searches coming out of Texas right now since Pornhub was shuttered in the state.
Oh, man.
If you're not aware, maybe you're not. Maybe you're a non-touching person. But Pornhub is saying, hey, look, we think it's a free speech issue, but... Texas has passed a new law that's complicated. So now a bunch of porn sites have followed as well, and they've blocked your ability to watch porn in the state of Texas. Google came out and said, here are the searches we've been seeing recently. And how to watch porn in Texas has ticked up an extraordinary 3,500%. However, the tick up is not in the Austin area. The Houston area, the Dallas area. You're going to be shocked and surprised, but it turns out the big blue cities don't seem to be having as many searches going into Google right now. Which three cities in Texas are leading the way with bizarre searches about how to watch certain kinds of porn.
Because it's going to be offensive.
Lubbock, Amarillo, Waco. Lubbock, Amarillo, Waco.
You think Lubbock was?
I don't think. I'm letting you know what
that's
just
what
came
it
out.
Is? Lubbock, Amarillo?
And Waco are the three cities that have had the largest percentage increase in searches regarding
porn.
Y'all
some freaks. Y'all some freaky little Texans.
Course, dude, anytime you tell people you gotta live a good life.
Shame, 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 shame.
Yeah. Come on, dude. Everybody's an undercover freak.
Let's shame these freaks.
So congratulations, Texas, for doing what you're supposed to. We do have to let you know about a death in the city. After just a year of operating in the Austin area, the Kroger company will be closing its delivery facility and laying off workers.
I never used them.
Maybe that was
the problem.
Kroger said on its website that it will close its Austin facilities May 25th. The grocery company wanted to break into the Austin market with its food delivery model instead of traditional retail stores. It had 90 zip codes on its delivery route, including Round Rock, Pflugerville, Bee Cave, Hutto, Cedar Park, and San Marcos.
How do you do that if you don't have a retail out? Do they go to shop at HEB and then bring it to you?
I don't know. HEB?
Or do they have a warehouse?
Yeah, a warehouse. Ladies and gentlemen, the death of Kroger just a year after opening.
Oh, my goodness.
We're announcing it here. But this means that while that's a sad death, it means time for victory. HEB has once again felled another competitor.
Yeah.
Send their family flowers, HEB, or something.
HEB should send the HE buddy out with flowers to the Kroger
location.
They have
a great flower section at HEB.
Mm-hmm. How could you? Here's the weird thing, though.
Your woman will never know.
Why won't HE? She knows, but she doesn't care. I will say, sometimes you cut the plastic off and then try to wrap it in paper.
They still know.
They still know. They still, because they go to HEB more and they know what we're doing. But come on, baby.
Come on,
baby. Baby, baby, please.
How many flower shops? Yeah, come on. Baby.
Baby, where would you rather me go? HEB or that other flower shop called the Yellow Rose? Which one should I go to get the flowers, baby? They got good flowers there, though.
Great flowers.
Thank you, HEB. Plus, I can pick up some shrimp. Show me a florist in town where I can get shrimp.
Nowhere.
I didn't think so. Anyway, Kroger's closed. Kroger, more like closer.
Yeah.
I got him good.
I hardly know her.
This is really exciting. Chewy loves pop-ups, and I know people love pop-ups. All the big, we've got an Hermes store now. I think we've got a Prada store. We've got, what else do we got? We got like Louis Vuitton. Mm-hmm. All the big stores from April 4th to April 6th. Pop-up experience in Austin on South Congress. Are you ready? It's the American Eagle Cafe coming to Austin.
Like the jeans?
What?
The American Eagle Cafe, a pop-up experience in Austin, will offer free coffee and pastries to those who stop by. Key denim styles will be on display throughout the pop-up, and QR codes will be included in the space for consumers to shop directly on AmericanEagle.com. The 400 square foot shop will be located at 1224 South Congress Avenue. Open from 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. They'll be serving coffee from local coffee shop Joe's Coffee.
This. Why? Who is.
As the number one jeans brand for Gen Z, we aim to create an innovative space inspired by our denim assortment where our customers can come hang with us. So,
I have a
wake up, Austin, and head on down to South Congress for the American Eagle Cafe pop-up.
Am I supposed to buy some jeans? Can I take this coffee?
Have you noticed that every new country act that comes out these days looks like an American Eagle Outfitters ad?
Yep. Yeah.
And lastly, ladies and gentlemen, Pie Bar is coming to South Austin, or I guess they just opened. A coffee shop on South Congress Avenue is on a mission to be a cozy community hub where people can satisfy their sweet tooth. The Pie Bar, scoops of pie.
Mm. Scoops?
So it looks like, you know when you go get ice cream and you get a scoop of ice cream with toppings?
Yeah.
Except they're doing like scoops of pie, I think?
Scoops.
I like it.
Pie Bar was originally in Lubbock. It closed in 2022. I guess we've been... Oh, I'm sorry. This has been open for a bit, I guess. Lisa Jackson said Pie Bar's extensive menu is part of her appeal. The unique concept creates a fun experience for both the customer and the person making their own pie. That's at 8900 South Congress Avenue. I brought it in because I know you like desserts sometimes there, Chewy. Have you ever been to the Pie Bar?
No, you can build your own mousse or cobbler cup.
That looks like...
Four-inch mini pies?
Cobbler in a cup, bro.
I'll feel like a giant.
Well, thought I'd throw it out there and give a little news because, you know what I mean? South Austin, that's good listening for us.
I may have to try that out.
Sometimes north of Austin's good listening for us, too. Central Austin, where nobody's commuting, they don't tend to listen to our show nearly enough. Keep in mind also, finally, this weekend, the big, what's that thing called? Where everybody goes to Zilker and puts a kite in the air?
The Kite Festival?
That's right. The 96th annual ABC Kite Fest is returning April 14th. Go ahead and put that on your calendar. It's headed up. We'll remind you about it later on as well.
Are you going to take your family to the Kite Festival?
I took them one time. It's a bit of a nightmare.
Really?
I mean, it was fun. Just because I had my kids were much smaller at the time. I haven't taken them since they've grown up. Maybe I will this year.
Maybe we all go.
Head out. Get a... That's kites. A busy weekend. Kite Fest, hand-built motorcycle show, Wild West Brew Fest. Reminder, folks, that we are Mornings with Matt and Bob. You can follow us online on Instagram, Matt and Bob FM. Matt and Bob FM, we always have information there. Mainly in our stories. We're not much for posting on the grid, but that'll change. There's some stuff happening there.
Is there?
Yeah, and some of the scripts are, I'm going to get them written when I'm out at the coast.
Nice. You're going
to
work.
From time to time, there's a wonderful thing that happens for the listener, which is where our brains aren't firing the way we want them to fire. Agreed, Bob?
Yeah. I mean, yeah. We keep things loose and, you know, and sometimes a little too loose. You know?
Does this morning feel like we're pushing?
No, it doesn't feel like we're pushing. It feels like a lot of content's going out, but it doesn't ever seem to be enough.
I guess that's what I mean.
You know what I mean? I feel like we've covered a lot of ground already, and it's like...
I just don't remember what I want to talk about. And then after the show, I'm like, why didn't I bring that up? That thing happened.
Heavy brain fog today. I think part of it was sleepless night.
We were digging out of hail yesterday.
I saw some of those pictures. But whenever that happens, the brilliant Bob Fonseca came up with a pocketable bit.
Mm-hmm.
And by I mean that it's always in our back pocket at any point, and we just go, hey, let's trigger it. And that's the ABCs of me. Mm-hmm. The ABCs of me.
Right. And I took that, you know, that's a direct quote from Cameron Crowe's script for Jerry Maguire, where Rod Tidwell accuses Jerry Maguire of not knowing the ABCs of me.
Mm-hmm.
Jerry, you know, show me the money.
Mm-hmm.
These are the ABCs of me.
And here's the ABCs of me and how it works. It used to just be Bob, but it's open to anybody. 512-834-0937. You can call and basically ask anyone on the show a question, and mm-hmm. they got to answer it.
Yeah. Get a little insight into the...
What's your greatest fear?
The person behind the mic.
What was your biggest mistake? How big is it?
Flaccid or...
I don't know.
Yeah. In metric system or imperial measurement?
Don't ask me flaccid.
I can't do metric either.
I'll never tell you the truth, flaccid. So.
Let's see, something I want to know about Chewy. I'm trying to think we can do it around the room a little bit.
Yeah.
I want to know why ABCs of you, like you were so hot on yesterday I talked about my obsession with the Swatch watch.
Right.
And how I missed out. By the way, there was almost a riot in London at the Swatch store for the Moon Snoopy. Mm-hmm. So I don't feel too bad wanting it. Apparently they had to shut down the whole operation.
A riot? Like
that's part of the scene in London.
Okay, but question. Are watch guys able to throw a fist?
Looks like a bunch of dudes wearing black here.
Those are cops.
No. Why have you cooled on the shoe game? Now, you were collecting Nikes. You were collecting, limited edition Jordans and things like that. What cooled with you on that?
I don't know what it is with Nikes, but they've cooled.
Oh.
Some of the color schemes that are coming out.
Or they're called colorways.
We're all like, hey, we're good.
Don't need that.
Yeah, we're good. And then occasionally, couple of months, something pops up that's very, very coveted.
Okay, because I was worried about you. I didn't know if it was a sign of some kind of shoe depression or something. Chewy hasn't got a new pair of kicks in like 6 months.
Do you think you'd ever go with a shoe manufacturer that isn't Nike? Would you ever collect?
Absolutely.
Would you ever collect a Reebok?
I do some Adidas and some New Balance.
I started buying some New Balance when they were on sale, super sale.
There were some slippers that are like bear claws the other day.
You know what? I still want that Big Lebowski collab with Hey Dude, but I haven't seen them anywhere. Or maybe online only. I don't know.
Let's hear from, is it Joyce or her husband?
Husband.
What's up?
What's up, Mr. Joyce?
Oh, no, I just had I know y'all get to go to like cool shows and backstage stuff. Just who was the,
Oh, yeah, so much backstage.
Bob does.
I can't even get backstage to our own podcast. I don't know.
Yeah. What was the question?
Yeah, go ahead. What's your question?
No, just like, who was the coolest or the you were most excited about meeting like a celebrity or like
who's the question for, sir? You can only pick one person.
For all y'all.
No, when I said you can only pick one person.
It's the ABCs of me, not the ABCs of us.
Yeah, so when the way the game works is...
I guess it'd be for Chacho.
All right.
Who's that?
Chewy? Chacho?
Oh, Chacho.
Coolest?
We call Chewy Chacho when we talk about Chewy.
Gotcha.
I think the Chacho is a name for something else, but I have an uncle named Chacho.
I have an uncle named Chago.
Chago or Chango?
Yeah, he was just as a piece down in Raymondville.
Huh.
I never met him, but I've always heard about it. Like, oh, Chago. Like a judge or something. I don't know.
I have, to be honest, sir, I don't live in the higher society where I get to go backstage and do all that stuff, so...
But you have met people in here.
Yeah, people in here. I mean, and again, my celebrity... I mean, I met everybody from, James Carville to... Who knows
RZA.
Who else? Kevin Hart to RZA to... But still, my favorite is Roy Jones Jr., because
That's hard to believe that he actually came in here.
I idolize him, so...
That's cool.
And
that's
I think
cool.
He was cool, because he emits a glow because he could just knock you
Did
out.
Did we have a good time with him? I
don't remember.
I don't remember the experience either. He was kind of in and out, but I don't remember being bad. I do remember the bad experiences.
Okay.
More than the good ones. So I'm assuming that it went well because I don't have a negative impression.
All right. Well, thank you, Joyce.
Thanks, man.
That's pretty cool.
That's
my answer.
That's good.
That's always my answer.
We learned a little ABCs of Chewy there.
Bob, we all good?
I got a question for Bob.
Do it.
Bob. What's the trip you wish you could take?
Oh, that's a good question. ABCs and me.
Yeah.
I really, my fascination with the Japanese vinyl bars.
I felt like I was going to be able to call it.
And I would love to.
I have a friend that went. I want to go with
him. I want to go to Tokyo and experience some of those small.
I have Japanese places saved, like I'm actually going.
Yeah, I want to get some street food and go to some of those vinyl bars, those whiskey bars.
Yeah.
You know, where I can actually get into one. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
As opposed to the one here.
Do you think you'll ever take that trip, or is it a trip you'll just want to take?
I'm not a... Here's some of the ABCs of me, and my wife and I joke about it all the time, and to some extent her. We are horrible vacation planners.
Mm-hmm.
We'll plan a vacation 3 days before it actually happens.
Right.
And we're terrible. I know people that book out their vacations years in advance, and they get a travel agent, and they know exactly where they're going and what they're doing and what they're... We're always last minute. Oh, we got this time.
My wife loves planning a trip and having it on the calendar months ahead of time because she says she loves the excitement. The thrill of thinking about it every day is part of the vacation. She does not like the last minute vacation because she's like, well, then that vacation.
You're getting less vacation.
She's like, I'm getting less vacation. I'm only getting the 3 days of the vacation. Whereas if you plan it a year in advance, I get 1 year of that vacation.
Anticipation, doing the research, reading books. Reading fodders or whatever.
I feel bad because I feel like I do cheat my wife in life because I'm not a planner.
I'm not either.
And so she constantly is being cheated from what she likes the most.
I think she plans trips and goes on them. But she doesn't need you.
That's true. That's true.
Now I would like to go to Tokyo or Japan and go to some of those places and just experience the culture. I think it's a very cool culture.
I hope you make it.
I don't know how that will happen. I don't know how that conversation even starts at home.
You got to choose between the Tesla truck and the Japan trips.
My father and stepmother spent 4 years planning a vacation to Japan.
Mm-hmm.
And then it got pushed back a little bit because COVID and everything got shut down. So that's why it took 4 years. And then they finally planned it down every single detail. The trains they were taking, where they were staying. They even found a company that would help porter their luggage from place to place. They were blowing it out. And they were like, this is going to be an incredible...
Once in a lifetime.
Like 23 days or something all through Japan. And 12 hours before they headed to the airport... my stepmother took a COVID test. And came up positive.
COVID is still a factor.
Came up positive and had to cancel the trip. They had to especially cancel the trip because Japan's one of those countries where they test you on the way into the country. Mm-hmm. And if you come up positive, they quarantine you for 21 days. You're not allowed to leave.
Right.
So luckily, she did test beforehand because it would. But yeah, that trip got blown out. After 4 years of planning.
That's the scary part about it. And travel ain't cheap.
It's not cheap. It's not cheap.
Especially you go international and you got to make all those arrangements and travel. And
I know my father was not happy about some of the money, some of the monies that were not returned. But who we got you? We got, are we getting any calls?
Yeah, we are. Sorry, Henry.
ABC's and me.
Castilla.
What's going on, y'all? I can't even believe I got through to one of the most highly awarded shows in the land.
Well, you know, we're clearing some space because I feel like there's more on the way in the next month.
I believe it. I got a question for Matt.
Yes, sir.
Who were the comedians you idolized growing up?
Oh, good question. This is such a good question.
Growing up is certainly different than today, but I remember clearly, I didn't know who he was. I just remember kids on the playground talking about somebody named Eddie Murphy. And I pretended to know who he was because you know how you were when you were like in elementary. You know, people were like, they were like, you heard that Eddie Murphy? And I was like, yeah,
Goony Goo Goo.
Yeah. And they were like, what was your favorite part? And I go, oh, all of it. But I remember going home and I remember telling my parents, I want to get a cassette of a comic named Eddie Murphy. And my parents were like,
not gonna do it.
And I was like, why not? And they're like, because we've heard it and it's not for kids. So I ended up talking to another kid on the playground, and he was like, I've got an extra copy. My brother has it. And I talked a kid into stealing his brother's copy, and then I paid him $10. I remember I saved up the money, and I got money.
Yeah.
And I bought the cassette, and it didn't have a cover on it. You know what I mean? He just got the cassette. It didn't come in a case or anything. He sold it to me on the playground. So I guess I was in fifth grade. I was at Edgar Martin. And I had that little, you know, that little cassette player that was black, black rectangle. It had the one speaker in it.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
And I turned the volume down really low. And then one night after my parents went to sleep, I woke myself up and I was under the covers and everything because I thought it would be quieter that way. And I put pillows on top of me and I listened to, I didn't know half the S he was talking about. You know what I mean?
Sure.
I didn't even know what he was, half the things he was.
The references. And
I was like, I don't know what AIDS is. What the hell is that? Come home and had AIDS, but I remember listening to that over and over and over again. And I listened to it as an adult, and I'm like, a lot of it did not age well, and some of it made him seem like he was an idiot. But I guess he was like the first comic that I really got into as a kid.
Mm-hmm.
As a kid.
Wow.
That's a good one. That's a good one, man.
That's a good one. Thank you, Mr. Costello.
Good question.
Great question. Let's go to Mr. Armstrong.
Yeah, a two-part question for Matt. Is there anything at all you miss about being on the road as a comic And yeah, if you ever did any morning radio, what's the most ridiculous morning show you ever sat in on?
Oh, okay. So what I miss the most, I think what I miss the most is it was a time to spend lots of hours kind of hanging out. If you got another good comic, that's the thing. It's like a lot of times you were staying in a condo and your feature would be there with you. And sometimes they were great and sometimes they weren't. And I was not at a level where I was bringing my own feature on the road. I was at a level where I was being given a feature, if that makes sense. Yeah, but it's weird because I think about it. I don't know how much I miss about the road. Performing was fun. Making money was fun. But honestly, it was kind of sad and miserable.
Yeah.
It's a little bit sad and miserable. Says. Yeah, so, but what was the second half of your question?
What crazy morning did you ever do?
Radio.
Yeah. Did you have to do like Bob and Tom or anything like that?
No. Here's what I'm going to say. Most morning radio, and this is why comics, I think, despise it. Most morning radio that I went on was terrible. Just absolutely terrible. They weren't interested in you. They didn't really ask you any questions.
They wanted to be, they try to be funnier than you.
They
right?
did not like someone coming on and being funnier, and right. they weren't trying to help you sell tickets or whatever. I got used, I mean, some of the comics that I mean, some of the morning shows I went into, the guys were pretty nice, mm-hmm. especially some of the places where I would go back frequently. The guy would be kind of nice, or you would watch the show go from three people to two people, then down to one person who was miserable. There was really only one other show that I went on that was ever good. The thing is, Austin spoiled me. The club in Austin, Cap City, was so cool. I thought that when I first got on the road, I thought every city was going to be that cool. And it turned out they weren't. And morning radio here was really fun and cool, and I thought they would all be that way, and they weren't. There was only one other show, and it was called Todd. It's up in Omaha, Nebraska.
Mm.
Todd and something and Todd show, and that was a really good show where they hung out and they BS'd. And now, what I really liked about their show is, unlike this room, they turn the lights down really low in the morning.
For some reason, I really
liked that feeling of the really low light and BSing instead of this bright ass stuff. Huh. But I can't give you the names of the. I mean, I went on to so many horrible shows. I mean, I would get on. One morning I got there and the jock was late. She was hot, but she had just gotten out of jail. And she had been in a fight with her. She'd been in a fight with her boyfriend the night before. And so she was just talking about that. And then she was asking me, do you think I should stay with him? And I was like, God, what a mess. You would go on sometimes and the jocks were fighting. They were just, they hated each other. Be like a guy and a girl. And she'd be like, you're an asshole. And the guy'd be like, shut up. And then they'd be like, all of a sudden be like, hey, we're back. That was Lady Gaga. And that was always weird to hear that behind the scenes, you know.
That's wild. Yeah, I listened to a little bit of a syndicated show.
I think that's more the norm than...
Yeah.
Across the country.
It taught me that this was a unique... That this building has always been a little unique with its morning shows.
We kind of came together organically, but I think in some places they just throw...
In most places they play a little money ball.
Yeah.
You get hired because they're like, oh, we need a personality that fits this. We need a personality that fits this demographic. And you're just told this is going to be
your team.
This
is your new partner. Yeah. Where we...
Thanks for the call,
we accumulate people kind of organically over the years on this show.
Hmm.
Accumulate. That sounds terrible.
512-834.
I want to know.
I have an ABCs. If you have an ABCs question,
now I know Matt. He knows that I collect plastic watches. Now I know that you have confessed to collecting pencils.
Yeah.
Have you added any pencils to your personal collection lately?
I have not had to purchase any pencils lately because the listeners have been so kind.
Oh.
Every year when we have like Christmas and certain events, whatever, listeners have just been, or listeners will sometimes find a pencil in a drawer and they'll mail it up here. And it's actually, to me, has made me appreciate my pencil collection way more than in the past, because before they were pencils I was buying for myself.
Right. Where's the sport in that?
Now having people, I've had a couple where people were like, I found this old Faber-Castell pencil. I don't know if it's worth anything, but I was cleaning out an old metal desk in my fab shop and found this. Mm. Thought you might like it. And have mailed it to me. And I'm like, I don't care if it has any value. It's way cooler knowing that the pencil has a story.
Right.
And then when people write me or send me notes, I keep the note with the pencil. So that's what my collection looks like now. It has these little
cool
stories. And so it's way less about the pencils themselves, I think, and way more about communication with people you'll never meet face-to-face. That's a weird part of our job, is that we are communicating with tens of thousands.
Yeah, people give me albums sometimes.
80, 90, 100,000 people, and you're never going to see most of them face-to-face.
Right.
Yeah, you're part of their life, and they're a part of it. It's, I like when they get to be a part of my life, too.
Very nice. ABC's and Matt.
We get anybody else calling, or did this one die on the vine?
No, we do. Let's go to Michael.
Yes, sir.
What's up, man? What's your question?
I do not have a question, but I just realized I had some pencils for Matt. So I need to get them to him. I got a buddy of mine that bought this building that's over 100 years old in this small town, and they got a whole case of these small pencils that are unused.
Hell yeah.
By small, you mean like golf pencils or what?
No, regular pencils.
Oh.
Number twos?
Nah, it's like a four. I don't know. It's something weird. It comes in a plastic case or whatnot. They're called Eagles or something.
Hell yeah. I'll take a look at them. Can you just send them to the station? Drop them by, mail them, whatever?
Yeah, I'll mail them.
Eagle pencils.
Okay. Hmm. All right. Thanks, Michael.
I appreciate it, Michael.
Yeah, that's Eagle turquoise or something like that.
I seem to remember Eagle when I was a kid, right?
Yeah. My grandmother used to use them. They used to use them in ledgers.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, this building's super old. It's called the Checker Dog out there in Flatonia. It's really cool.
Flatonia. Flatonia is just south of Lubbock. Is that right?
It's in next to LaGrange.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. I know I've seen the sign. I know I've seen the sign on the way to Houston or something.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What's he doing What's he doing?
Ready to run the trains. From Houston to San Antonio, and that's going to be one of their stops.
Really? What's he doing with a building in Flatonia?
She owns a vintage place and stuff like that. That's so cool. This place is super cool. They got like an old Eagle in there. It's really cool. Old family had owned it.
Cool, man. Thank you very much. Appreciate
Thanks.
The call.
Thanks, Michael. Let's go to...
Got time for, I think, one more, two more. It's ABCs of me. You can call us with any question.
Lindsay.
Yes, Jason.
Ugh. Son of a bitch.
What's your question, bud?
It's a question for the show.
Okay.
All right.
What's out of the odd? Is that from Rick and Morty?
The what is?
The voice from Nods to the Odd.
Oh, no. That's just a regular voice guy.
Yeah.
Does it sound like a Rick and Morty guy?
Yeah, it sounds like the dad.
Yeah, no, we got a voice. Well, I don't know. We've got a voice guy out in California that does a lot of like the station identity stuff.
Now, Chris Parnell does the dad on.
Oh, does he? Yeah. So, but we've never met him. You send an email to him, and then he sends tracks to a guy down in San Antonio that mixes them, and then they get sent here. We don't use a lot of them for the morning show. They get used mainly for the other day parts or whatever. But yeah, I don't know anything about it other than that. I'm sorry if we can't give you better information.
They keep that secret.
They both have good voices.
Secret identity, yeah.
Yeah, it's just sounding like them. Thanks, sir.
All right. Hey, that's a good question. Why not, you know?
I think our voice guy sounds like L.A. Lloyd.
Really?
I think we could save a couple bucks and pay
and just get L.A. Lloyd
to do the identity stuff.
Forward Mornings with Matt and Bob presents Nods to the Odd.
All right, my good friends, let's get into a couple of odd stories that we have found around the internets.
Hey, do me a favor. Make them super weird, okay?
Well, I can't do that. I can only do what the internet provides.
Give me like the craziest.
Well, I'll give you an example of some of the odd stuff happening around in Cheshire, England. Can you tell me where Cheshire is?
Yeah.
Where is it?
England.
Well, I know it's in England, but you grew up in England. Is it like south of London?
Well,
north
it's not
of London?
On the coast.
It's not.
I'm going to say it's kind of in the south. You know, the big fat part of England. You know, down Cheshire way.
Well, in Cheshire,
near Cheshire.
Okay, in Cheshire, there's a place called the Lower Moss Wood Nature Reserve and Wildlife Hospital.
Uh-huh.
God, they love words in England. The Lower Mosswood Nature Reserve and Wildlife Hospital. A woman rescued an abandoned baby hedgehog. You guys familiar with the hedgehog?
Mm-hmm.
Very popular these days on Instagram.
Sometimes they call them badgers.
She took a picture of it. She rescued the baby hedgehog. She put out food for it. It would not eat. She tried to keep it warm and use a lamp for it. and eventually realized that the baby would not eat. She got very she got very nervous, and so she decided, she brought it to the animal hospital. She said she's concerned it has not moved or pooped all night. That's when the veterinarian there, Janet Kotsky, or Kotze, was called in to observe the baby hedgehog. Oh. And she said, I was informed that a kind soul had rescued the baby hedgehog. Unfortunately, the baby hedgehog was not going to make it. The older woman... was in her 60s or 70s. She had seen the hedgehog on the roadside. She had collected it. She tried to feed it cat food, but it did not move because it was not alive.
What? Gold rings. They like gold rings.
Now, this doesn't seem that odd, does it, as a story? Somebody rescued a dead... the reason it's on in the odd is that she had rescued the pom-pom from off the top of a beanie hat. You know what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
Like a beanie, like a warm weather.
Yeah.
She had seen a pom-pom on the side of the road and thought it was a baby hedgehog.
No.
And she is and brought it in. And the reason it wasn't eating is that pom-poms don't eat.
You want to know some more ABCs than me? I've never been able to work I could never get a toque with a pom-pom on top to work for me.
Really?
Yeah.
You try to pull it down too tight?
I don't know. I don't know how to wear it.
What's the purpose of the pom-pom?
I don't know, but I see a lot of guys that can pull it off.
There's no functionality?
You know, it's a knit hat, knit cap, like a regular knit cap.
Right.
Like the Edge would wear, except it has a big furry pom-pom.
I prefer the ones with the pom-pom.
I know, but
on top.
I can't make it work for me. I don't know if it's, I guess it's off-brand for me or something. I don't know.
Yeah, if I'm going to wear a knit hat, I already know I don't look cool, so I'm not going to try to wear one that looks cool. I'm going to try to wear one that looks idiotic, because I'm going to lean into the fact that a knitted hat on top of your head looks
weird. I've got
weird.
One from El Dorado Cafe that they gave me.
That's the one I wear with the pom-pom on top.
Okay.
It looks great.
No offense to El Dorado. I appreciate the gift. I can't pull it off.
Now, why don't you just
The rugby team gave me one, an orange and black one. I can't pull it off.
Why don't you just clip the pom-pom off?
Isn't that like the tag on a
mattress?
On a mattress?
You know what? I think you're right. The government doesn't allow you to cut the tag off, do they? You go straight to jail. Has anyone... Why are we not allowed... Oh, I guess the consumer can remove the tag, but nobody else can?
Something.
There's some confusion.
I don't think we need the pom-pom either, though. I don't think... And you don't look intimidating. You're not going to want to fight with a pom-pom on the top.
I don't know. I can see like Conor McGregor wearing one. He'd be pretty intimidating.
They're like, I mean, I compare it to like capes, you know? We don't need that.
Doesn't Waldo wear one? You know that character?
Yeah.
Where's Waldo? Doesn't he have one of those pom-pom hats?
The character created in
not
like,
threatening
63
at all.
Or something?
Speaking of animals, ladies and gentlemen.
Mornings with Matt and Bob presents Nods to the Odd.
An influencer is under a little bit of trouble. Her name is Abby Saleh. She's a Filipino online influencer. She's come under fire for alleged animal cruelty because she designed a hat that is a small cage that has a live bird inside of it that she's wearing on her head.
Mm.
She's calling it duckling fashion, and people are saying it's cruel to do to the animal.
Yeah, the animal doesn't have a choice. He don't want to be in your hat.
Mm-mm.
Photos.
Oh, Jackie Childs.
Well, the thing is that most people wear these fake ducks on top of their head as some kind of fashion thing. She decided to build a cage and put an actual living duck on her head. Outrage has come from animal rights defenders the world over. This is animal cruelty, they say. Is it? Sorry. Hmm. Am I coming off as someone who's uncaring?
No.
I mean, an hour in a... It's a duckling. I don't know. I hope the chick is still alive, someone wrote. Well, she's clearly alive. She's wearing an outfit. She's walking around doing influencing. Oh, the duck chick. Never mind.
Mm.
No? Okay, that one did not inspire anything from you guys.
I don't know what to say. I feel like...
It did not inspire anything
from
you guys.
I feel like in olden days with the hoop skirts and stuff in England and things like that, like in the old Renaissance, didn't they... Weren't they didn't wear cages on their heads?
Cages?
Is some kind of decorative thing with birds in them? Why am I picturing that?
I have no idea. But I mean,
I think it's a throwback.
Oh, you used to have the platform shoes with the goldfish in them. I don't know why.
Nobody
this
cares
is crazy.
About fish. You can do anything to a fish. Nobody cares.
They people don't care about fish.
They don't care about fish.
Who does care about fish is Kathy the Cat Lady. She calls in occasionally to defend the fish, but yeah. I think she may be the only
Mornings
one.
Mornings with Matt and Bob presents Nods.
She can talk to the odds.
Vietnamese doctors were recently called into the emergency room to save a young man's life. On March 20th, a 34-year-old man was admitted to the Hai Ha District Medical Center in Quang Ninh Province, Vietnam.
Why is that hospital laughing at me?
I don't know. He had severe abdominal cramps. He was in too much pain to even be questioned about his symptoms. The hospital staff conducted an x-ray.
That's Panda Express.
And an ultrasound. And it revealed a foreign body in his abdomen, as well as an intestinal perforation and peritonitis. Doctors decided the best course of action... surgery. Oh. Emergency surgery to remove the suspicious object. Doctors were surprised to find that the foreign object was a 2-foot-long eel.
Yeah, they get... that's. I don't swim with eels, man. They can get in there.
It was How did he get in?
Oh, you don't want to know.
I think we want to know exactly. When asked, the 34-year-old man did not want to provide a clear answer as to how a slippery animal could have gotten into the man's colon.
Probably felt like a good idea for a bit.
They said that it was clear that it had entered. The eel was still alive inside the man's body.
Well, how are you going to get the mouse out? You know?
Oh,
yeah. They had to be removed through the abdomen. Part of the man's intestine had become necrotic, meaning it was dead, and they had to cut it out. Yeah. But the man refused to answer how possibly a long, thick, live eel ended up inside of
you
his colon.
You added the word thick.
I sleep
you?
On my stomach.
Thick was not in. I want to see the. Story.
That's
thick,
thick
was not in there. You are editorializing. Shame on you during a news segment.
Here's the literally what it says.
Shame on you.
Doctors believe the long, thick, slippery, throbbing, ridged, veiny animal crawled from the anus to the patient's colon. God. Though how it entered his anus, they're unsure.
We'd like to see it, but Texas is blocking the site.
They said that it was clear that the eel had been plied with multiple drinks and a couple of stories at a bar before entering the man's anus.
Hmm.
There you go.
Wow.
Thought you would enjoy that one. I hope you did.
Mornings with Matt and Bob presents Nods to the Odd.
And finally, the Vermont State University, which I don't know where Vermont State is.
It's got to be a party school, right?
I can't name one city in Vermont. I don't even know the capital. Montpelier?
No. Harvard has announced their own course on the music of Taylor Swift. So Vermont State has decided to offer their own course on Weird Al Yankovic.
I don't hate it. I did walk out of a Weird Al show, though.
I like that because Weird Al will come in and probably
speak. It's not
speak.
That good.
The Harvard University's school's class is called Taylor and Her World. The performing arts professor, Brian Warwick, has started a class at VTSU titled Weird Al and His Polkas. The school said that while the class name and much of the subject matter is based around humor, students may also learn some serious concepts. I like how they threw May in there. We don't know. I mean, we might have some. Hey, let's be honest.
I think it's up to the student.
Who are we kidding?
Yeah. You guys are going to Vermont State. It's not like you're even going to a real school.
Pancakes for breakfast every day.
People probably think it's online.
Warwick has worked as an audio engineer for Yankovic's albums.
Sure he has.
So I guess he has a little bit of background and what all is going. He said the class is going to look at the larger cultural context surrounding the artist's works. You know, the cultural context around songs like Eat It or Amish Paradise.
I like fat.
I know from my experience at UT, those classes are very tempting to take.
I bet they are.
And then once you get it, because you think they're going to be easy and easy A, and then you get in there and you're trying to fight your way out. It's like,
well, it's tough.
This
because
is not fun at all.
Well, because you have to live with an entire, you have to live for an entire semester with a single joke,
right?
Which is I'm gonna take the Weird Al class. But the joke wears off after a bit.
After the homework assignments start rolling in and the papers you have to write.
And you're like, I'm actually having to write a paper about Weird Al Yankovic right now. This is not fun whatsoever. Ladies and gentlemen, that is today's foray into the Nods to the Odd.
Mornings with Matt and Bob presents Nods to the Odd.
Well, there you go, ladies and gents. Guess what? Today is National Food on a Stick Day.
We all love food on
That's
a stick.
That's been our inspiration. We've got some tickets to give away here in a little bit, and we're going to give those tickets away in a contest that deals with food on a stick. So you prepare yourselves. Prepare thyself.
Do your research.
Good morning, it's Matt and Bob. We're powered by Chewy. Hallelujah. We have tickets today, don't we, to give away? We gave away two pair yesterday, didn't we?
Yeah, because they're softies.
So this is going to be our last pair available then?
We have a big, you're correct.
Okay.
And we have a big metal audience. That's why we're giving away Five Finger Death Punch with Marilyn Manson and Slaughter to Prevail on September 18th at Germania Insurance Amphitheater, which is at COTA.
I know that.
And if you want those tickets and you want to compete for those, 512-834-0937 as we celebrate Food on a Stick Day.
Yeah, so you give us a ring right now, that number that... should we give it the number one more time?
512-834-0937.
And you'll ring up. Chewy's going to pick Bob. Chewy's going to... Are you a fan of the food on a stick there, Bob?
I think it should all be on a stick.
Everything should be on... Why is it... Food on a stick sometimes does have its own kind of magic, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Is it just because you're generally at a fair or doing something unusual that it is so much better?
It makes it easy.
I think that fourth or fifth bite, though, gets a little scary. Because you got to put more of that sharp stick in your mouth to get to that final kebab.
Dude, you got
to
scoot the... You got to scoot the... You scoot the food up the stick.
I'm not touching it with my hands.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow. So you just deep throat that whole thing?
Skewer gloves now?
You go full Rick Perry?
Yeah, you have to. No, it wasn't Rick Perry. It was the old mayor, wasn't it?
It was Rick Perry, too.
Oh, no, that was the hot dog with the old mayor.
Let's see. I hope these are some ladies. I'll be mad if they're not. Is this Laura?
Yeah.
Yes.
Hey, Laura. Hi, you competing for some Five Finger Death Punch?
Yeah, I wanted to get tickets.
Well, you're going to have to work for it. We're going to do a contest here. Are you prepared for that?
What kind of contest? I just got in the car.
Do you even know what you're attempting to win tickets for?
Yes.
What?
Five Finger Death Punch with Marilyn Manson.
Oh, okay. Okay. You can answer that. Okay,
All right, we're gonna have to
The beginning of this had the feeling of someone just trying to grab tickets for willy nilly. Laura, it's food on a stick day, so you're gonna have to compete in a trivia contest about food on a stick. Okay,
so be thinking of food on a stick.
Yeah, what do you do here in the city, Laura?
I work at a hospital.
Nice. Thank you for that. Thank you for your service.
And when you say you're a healthcare worker, do you, are you like a nurse? Do you have to put your fingers inside of anybody? Or are you selling stuffed animals at the gift shop?
I'm not a nurse, but I work as a therapist.
Likely story. Mm. Likely story. All right, Laura, hang tight. We're going to get your competitor right now.
Let's find your opponent. Is this Trinity?
This is her.
Oh, Trinity, yes, I love that we have two ladies competing for Five Finger Death Punch tickets.
Trinity, what do you do here in our fine city of Austin, Texas?
I'm a barista.
Is that a child in your car right now?
Yeah, I'm also a stay-at-home mom.
Whew, that's brutal. Congrats to you. I'm sorry that you made that decision. As a fellow parent, I'm sorry you decided to have children. I know how brutal it can be. It's tough. Remember what life used to be like when you were single and you were out partying all night doing lines of coke? And now it's just you and a child driving around. Anyway.
Yep.
Enough of those fair memories, Trinity. You're competing against Laura. Laura, meet Trinity. Trinity, meet Laura. Here's the deal, guys. For our contests, you your buzzer is the way you ring in. We control all the rules. That's the way it works over here. There's only one winner. We have six questions today about food on a stick. Trinity, can you test your buzzer, please?
You just say your name, Trinity.
No, oh, she actually.
No, your name is your buzzer.
Your name is your buzzer.
Loud Trinity, and clear.
Sorry.
Trinity and Laura, test your buzzer.
Laura.
Okay, that works. So when you hear a question, if you think you have the answer, we only take answers from people after they've buzzed in. Who wants to go first on this
I'll
one?
I'll go
right
first.
Here? Okay.
Oh. All right. This frozen confection on a stick. I'm looking for the trade name for this frozen confection that has generally has like a orange sherbet on the outside surrounding an ice cream, a vanilla ice cream core. What's the trade name for that?
I got it.
Trinity.
What's the name we're looking for?
Creamsicle.
I'm looking for the trade name, though. What do we call it? Rhymes?
Laura. Popsicle?
It's not popsicle.
No.
And it's not creamsicle, guys. The one we're looking for, the actual name is?
Dreamsicle.
Dreamsicle. Give me that dreamsicle. Oh. Yeah, you were so close, yet
so far away from me.
You know what, ladies? I'll keep it in the popsicle arena.
Uh-oh.
Because it could be my favorite food on a stick. But this particular popsicle is an ice cream that's made up of sections of banana and chocolate. My favorite.
Trinity. Bomb Pop?
You're very close. I don't know if I can give it to you, and I want to be nice, but it's two ladies, so I got to be fair.
The judges are saying no.
Laura, you want to take a shot at it?
Laura?
Is it Choke a Banana?
Choke a banana.
No. The name?
Never, I choked a banana a couple nights ago. My wife was out of the house.
It is not Choco Banana.
Wouldn't that technically be a Choco Banana and not Choco Banana?
Choco Banana. It is actually a bomb stick. A bomb stick.
Man,
I'm sorry.
Stick
very
was
close.
In the name.
Very close.
All right, ladies, here we go. Question number three. Currently, the score is 0-0, but I have a feeling it's going to change right here. Food on a stick is one of my favorite parts of any kind of rodeo or fair or anything like that. In Dallas, every fall, you can find the giant Texas State Fair. I haven't gotten to the question yet.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Who is the giant character that greets you at the Texas State Fair?
Trinity. Big Tex.
Trinity is on the board.
One point
for Big Tex.
That's a good
one. Howdy, folks.
I like that one.
Howdy, folks.
All right. This popular food on a stick is loved by kids and adults alike. It has two simple ingredients. Spun sugar and food coloring.
Trinity.
Cool.
Cotton candy.
We'll put the circle there.
Damn.
That's 2 points for Trinity.
Love cotton candy.
There's an opportunity for Laura to catch up right here, but she's really going to have to work for it.
All right. This one, I know you ladies know this one, so get your buzzers ready. I go to this place specifically for the food on a stick on free sample weekend.
Trinity.
What wholesale
Trinity.
Store? Yes.
Costco.
That is correct, Trinity.
Costco is correct. Here's the thing.
Is there any path?
This is the final question, and this final question is worth 3 points. So there's a chance that Laura could tie it up right here.
How coincidental.
Do you think it's worth three points? Can I ask you a question, Bob? This is off air, and nobody can hear you right now. But do you think if this is two dudes playing, I would make it as easy for someone to catch up and tie?
No.
You think if it was two dudes playing, I'd just be like, whatever, hang up on them, who cares?
Yeah, we'd never put them on.
But sometimes sexism works in people's advantage, doesn't it?
Yes, it does.
And right now it's working in advantage we've got ladies on the phone. All right, Laura.
Here we go.
Everybody's rooting for you to maybe tie up, and some people are rooting for Trinity to win it all. Here we go. Final question. Every single fall, you can enjoy food on a stick at this nod to German heritage, which takes place in New Braunfels, Texas.
Trinity.
Worstfest is correct. Worstfest is correct. That means Laura scores 0 points.
0 points.
Laura.
Trinity gets 6 points.
Don't leave, Laura.
Don't leave why, Laura?
Don't leave why?
Well, why don't you want Laura to leave? She didn't get any points.
I know, but I just want the ladies to stick around.
Why?
Like they should be.
Okay.
Why you want her to meet stick Laura? Around? Why?
Because we have two pairs of tickets.
So you're just going to give tickets to Laura for doing literally nothing?
Shane Moss said it right.
Oh, my God. I did
for beautiful
Costco.
Women.
I shot
that Costco. She put the a goose
egg
up.
For beautiful women, the world is a magical place.
Yes. And that's what we're experiencing here today.
Trinity showed how she got out there. She worked hard.
Uh-huh.
She struggled. She's got 6 points. And you're saying, well, the world's going to be just as So she did all the work, but Laura's also going to get tickets?
And saddled with a kid.
And with a kid. And she's still...
And still...
So you don't want Laura... You don't want Trinity to feel at least like, hey, I bested somebody?
I mean, look. Them the breaks. Thank you, ladies, so much.
Neither of you win tickets today. No, I'm kidding. Chewy wants you both to get tickets. So, Chewy, do me a favor.
Look, those metalheads need some ladies over there at that concert.
That is true. That is going to be a concert. Five Finger Death Punch should just be a bunch of dudes in black t-shirts, arms crossed, nodding their heads.
Mate.
At least Trinity and Laura will show up, and that'll be the only two that are there, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
Nice. All right, both of you hang on. Trinity's got to get both of y'all's information. Nobody else go anywhere. We're still here for like another hour, which is incredible because we're really the best show that's ever existed. We're Matt and Bob. We're Chewy. We're Trinity. We're Laura. We're suckers
everybody.
For ladies.
City.
Headed to the beach. The Bearden Clan is with some friends for my wife's birthday. Okay. And my wife has been... I don't know. We're going for, like, I think 36 hours. And my wife... There is a giant mountain of stuff that she's already got piled by the
door.
Do
your kids get tired of doing all this stuff?
I don't know. I've never talked to my children.
Yeah.
I don't know if they have opinions or feelings. I don't know. I don't discuss anything with them.
Just get in the car and shut up.
So much stuff. There is...
Like what?
Are we there yet?
Look at me. Bob, as a father, is there any worse trip than the beach trip?
Deep sea fishing, unless you're going to go on a pier, toss in a line.
It's good for me.
I didn't ask as a guy.
Beach.
I said as a father.
I love a good beach.
I don't think anything is good.
But I find
father.
I get resistance.
You love
everybody.
The beach?
Yeah, I love the.
Putting all that, having to carry all that stuff out, set it up.
Yeah, once I'm there, I get a little Bluetooth radio, listen to the waves.
And then have to break it all down every afternoon
I'm
and bring
all right
it back.
With it. I'm all right
really?
With it. I get a calming feeling.
Teach me how to find
ocean.
That calming feeling
I belong.
About the setup
I should have joined the Navy. I don't know.
Give me a rooftop pool.
I'm fine with it. The sitting, I'm fine with. It's the setup, the breakdown.
I know, it's tough.
The feeling of
sand
all over your body, stuck to yourself.
You burn, too, I bet. You look like you burn.
What the hell is that supposed to be?
I just see. You look like you might
sunburn. What is that? Is that? That's racist.
No, it's not.
Saying you might sunburn?
No, I think what he said was racist. He said, I look like a guy who would burn.
You look like you burnt before.
Do you burn?
Come on. Don't be silly.
I bet you do if the Spanish throw you in a fire.
I'll burn one right now.
I'm terrified of getting in the water anymore, though. I said the other day on the show, I don't think I'll ever get back into like a natural body of water ever again.
Just because the creepies
it's just
and the crawlies?
Never,
brain amoebas, flesh-eating anything.
Red tide.
Sea urchins.
All
sea horses do something.
Eels.
The males give birth.
Thick eels.
Do you guys know what a blue dragon is?
Yeah, I've seen those because they put a little warning out down at the Texas coast
Yeah, blue glacus. Sea slugs, they live in very certain areas, but because of the weather changes, I'm not going to say global warming so that some of our listeners will continue to stay here even when they get mad about hearing about climate change.
Hey, it's Texas.
The blue dragon is now actually in the Gulf of Mexico, and I know it to be true because guess what?
Jeez. That wants to crawl on your butt.
Guess what? The last time we were at the beach, my son and I saw one of these, and I was like, I don't know what that is. Stay away from it. What I didn't know is this slug feeds on the man-o-war, what are those things called? Stingrays? Not stingrays. What's it called?
Manatees?
No, that thing that floats in the water and can sting you. Jellyfish.
Jellyfish.
They feed on jellyfish. They ingest all the stinging enzymes from the jellyfish. And then so one of these things has the sting of like 1,000 jellyfish because they've sucked it all in there and then they can use it themselves.
Ouch.
It's like a concentrated jellyfish, but the thing is only like an inch long. The reason I know about it, I'm not kidding. The last time we went to the beach.
You saw one of these.
This fall.
These things look like aliens.
I was like, check this thing
out.
And my son and I were like, what is it? And I said, I don't know what it is. I've never seen one, but I'm going to say don't touch it because.
Don't touch it.
I've never seen it, I don't know what it does. It turns out what it does is it stings the hell out of you.
Yeah.
It probably ain't that bad.
I looked it up, and here it just says, spring breakers, beware, tiny toxic blue dragons, don't touch them. The next thing, blue sea dragon, do not touch this creature. Look, but do not touch. Blue dragons wash ashore in Texas. Huh. They're all saying, stay away, stay away, stay away, stay away, stay away. Blue dragons, known scientifically as Glaucus atlanticus, sail on the surface of the ocean feeding on toxins from Portuguese man-o-war. But apparently they're now hanging out inside the Gulf of Mexico. People accidentally step on these blue dragons, and it does not end well, says Jace Tunnel, a marine biologist at Texas A&M University, Corpus Christi.
See, why do you want to go to the beach? Why? What is so great? I mean, it's nice to look at.
I used to go when I was a kid.
But the sand gets everywhere. You got all kinds of crazy stuff in the water ready to...
I know.
Sting you.
It just feels like it's something that you should do. It's a rite of passage.
No, stop. Tradition is going to kill the humanity.
I know. There's something about it. I remember going when I was very young, going to Virginia Beach or somewhere like that. I can't remember all the beaches on the East Coast. I used to go to Jersey Shore. I don't know. There's something about it. It was magical back then.
I guess I just
didn't know any better.
I've only been to if you take me to you know, Turks and Caicos or something where the... Where the water's
Hawaii's
clear,
nice.
Or Bora Bora, but Galveston, a Texas beach. That's the one thing where Texas is inferior to others.
Oh yeah,
everything else I think we're pretty solid except for the
one thing we're inferior is what?
We have gray water, green water,
our government, and our beaches.
I don't know. I like our beaches. They're ours. You know what I mean?
I don't see him that way, but
throw some chlorine in there.
Yeah, do something. Throw some blue dye in there,
please.
I mean, something.
Actually, I saw one.
Any water, any beach where I can't see my feet.
I know, but
water.
We actually have surf that you can bodyboard in and stuff like that. You don't get any. You go over to Florida and you get those little waves that go lap, 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 lap.
That's actually the wake of the oil tankers going by. That's not even real. Texas beaches, those aren't even real waves. Those are wakes.
Also, Texas beaches are great because you have the best chance of having a giant wad of cocaine wash up on a Texas beach.
You might score.
And if you go to a southeast Texas beach, you're going to spot an alligator.
Wait, what?
That's right. That's what KV reported. They posted this video here.
An alligator washed up on a beach in South Texas?
That's where I'm headed,
South Texas beach. Hell yeah. I guess I'm just kind of doomed. Well, you guys wish me luck.
Yeah. I want to know the stuff that's stacked at the door.
All right.
We literally have a minute and a half. We can push the 42.
Let's go ahead and wash it over. All right. Let us...
We're back in 90 seconds.
Oh, that's real? All we have is literally 90 seconds?
Yeah, and we're missing 90 seconds in the next break, so...
Okay, well, let's just...
Now you want to hear about the alligator?
You guys want to continue to talk about the beach? Yeah, let's combine it all into one. Let's just keep talking.
I want to know the things that are stacked at your front door ready to go. Like, what do you need for 36 hours at
the
beach?
Are there, like, volleyball? What do you, sandcastle? I'll build a sandcastle.
Buckets, cool. What? Shovels?
Buckets, shovels, tents.
Tents?
Yeah.
You're camping on the beach?
I might like to camp on the beach, but I want to dig one of those giant, like, holes where we can all sit in and have a campfire. You ever see them?
Sometimes they'll fill in with water, though.
Yeah,
if you
that's
dig
fine.
Too deep.
My wife really wants to have a fantastic trip. I also have a pair
Tell
of...
Tell her to go somewhere else.
Yeah, the where beach. The water's blue.
The beach isn't
maybe
the place.
The Cayman Islands
Hang
or
on.
Something.
Hang on, Kim.
Destin, Florida.
Remember where my wife grew up?
Ski shores.
My wife grew up in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, where there a beach is...
It's a lake beach.
Somebody takes a big dump truck and dumps a bunch of sand on the edge of a little tiny... And when I say lake, it's not like lakes we have here. They're little tiny lakes. They're
lake
the
beach,
the
right?
They're the size of like a mall.
Yeah. Brown water.
Brown water, and it's mud, and that's their beach. And they go when it's like 55 degrees. They're like, oh, thank God, summer's here.
Lake beach.
So she thinks that the Texas Gulf Coast, even though she's like, yeah, I guess
that's
it's not
the
as
Riviera.
Pretty as... Well, no, she doesn't think that. Oh. She's been to nice beaches, but she likes it. And it's her birthday, and she's taking some
fun. Oh, it's
birthday.
Her birthday?
Yeah.
Then you're allowed
Again?
To do stuff.
I thought it was her birthday last week.
Well, yeah, it was, but we couldn't take a trip that week.
I see how it goes. Family dynamics.
Yeah.
Mm. I hope you have a good time and don't burn as much as Chewy says you're going to.
You wear sunblock, right?
Feels like you're going to burn on the inside and the outside.
Do I need sunblock?
Do you need sunblock?
You need like SPF 100.
Have you heard of melanoma?
Have you heard of melatonin?
Have you heard of Maureen? Maureen!
Actually, no, that's my wife. This is Sean.
Oh, Sean.
All right, Sean.
What's up, Sean?
Yeah, sorry. No, I was calling about, y'all were talking about Texas beaches, and I'm with Chewy. Texas beaches suck. So, we used to have a beach house down in Galveston Island, and everybody in the hood... Everybody back in the day, this is in the 80s, I guess.
Yeah.
Everybody had, if you remember this, if you went to the beaches then, had baby oil at the bottom of the steps. And it had a little sign, please wipe your feet. You had to wipe off the tar from the oil rig of all the tar in the beaches.
Matt loves that because he grew up in that.
Okay, first
he wants
of
to
all,
rub it all over
he
his
wants
body.
To
That's
come
his
out.
Sunscreen.
I wonder why I'm a little off.
Tar it up.
I wonder if it's because I swam in oil infested gulf.
Now, there are natural tars that wash up on the beach, sir.
Oh, natural
that
tar.
Is organic.
It's good old fashioned organic tar is what that is. Yeah. And you're trying to blame that on the oil industry, which, by the way, has built this great
state.
We
won't hear it in Texas.
We'll not hear it. We'll not hear it. What do you know what redfish loved? If you know why our redfish are so big and beautiful here
juicy,
on the Texas
delicious.
Coast, is that they feed on that tar and it makes them, it gives them explosive size.
Well, we did fish by the oil rigs, and yes, the redfish were amazing out there.
Thank you very much.
Maybe you got me there.
It's because they're feeding on two things. One is the tar that's coming off of the rig. And secondly, it's the unused welding rods. Because I remember when I used to work offshore, we would take welding rods. And if you throw them at a right angle, they'll hit the water. Once they hit the water, they'll take off through the water and it makes a weird sound. So you're bored and that's what we did. I probably shouldn't say that now. Are they going to come back? Is my old company going to come back and dock my pay?
Yeah, they're going to charge you more for oil products. Thank you, sir. Can you think of a positive quality for the beaches and the kids out there this summer? Please give us some positivity.
Yeah, there's no on Galveston. There's no more shells, so you don't have to worry about stepping on anything.
It is really sad. It really, really sad that there's literally zero shells on the beach.
What
They've
happened
all
to
been
them?
Harvested.
They're all on broth.
Yeah,
I thought they come out at night or something.
The shells come out at night.
Hey,
the shells come out at night.
I thought more wash up on the shore or something.
There are no shells on Texas beaches anymore. They've been all taken over the years by people.
So what is Shelly going to sell by the seashore?
Yeah. Her... almost said it.
Maureen, thank you. Have a good one, Sean. I'm sorry.
Yeah, no, good. Have a good one. Bye.
Thanks, if anybody... 512-834-0937. If you can just think of something positive about the beaches. I don't find the shell thing positive. I want a shell.
I look, it makes me sad. When I was a kid, I would collect sand dollars. There's when I'm out there now, you cannot find a single shell. All you can find are blue dragons.
It wouldn't feel like
you.
A beach.
It is odd.
Not it's even one of those little, what are they, Kongs, conks, whatever?
Well, you're definitely not fine. Look, any kind of shell you would want, you're not, now you'll find tiny, from tiny little like mussels and stuff, you'll find those shells. But all the big, beautiful things like the angel wings, all of it is gone, dude. It's all just been picked over, I guess, because
what
of the
is
people.
You gotta go to the gift shop. You gotta go to the gift shop. You gotta go through the shark's
jaw. That's what I think it is.
To get to the gift shop.
The shark's mouth gift shop paid somebody to go collect all the shells because they were like, not enough people are coming here to buy shells. So let's. And then all the shells are always imported from like Malaysia.
Mm-hmm.
So you're not even buying shells from a Texas beach when you go buy shells at one of those shelleries.
Right. Mm-hmm. They come over in a container.
Let's hear from
on a tanker.
Kim or Kim's husband.
This is Kim's husband.
What's up, Kim's husband?
Hey, my name is Paul. Hey, I just wanted to say, man, so you know there are rattlesnakes ending up on the Gulf in Galveston and stuff, man, so y'all be careful.
What? Oh, my God.
Really?
Where are we going, dude? Yeah. Where is my family going? There's gators and rattlesnakes.
Sounds like you're taking them to Australia. Yeah.
I know.
Yeah. In Galveston, they found a 7-foot Western Diamondback rattler.
What does your wife want to go to this place for?
I don't know, dude.
Bro, y'all have money to go to the Bahamas. Y'all need to switch
that
up.
I know.
Go to Bahamas. Thank you, sir. Thank you for warning.
Costa Rica
for warning
or something.
We're going. Dude, the last time we went down there to the same area by like St. Louis Pass, the mosquitoes were so thick that we would have to run to the beach. Literally run because you'd go through the dunes area and they would just swarm all around you. So you would get all the way to where you were and then you'd have to smack all the ones that had attached to you and were sucking blood.
Finally.
The Texas coast has become inhospitable.
The guy smoking a joint is winning because they're not going into the smoke.
The rattlesnakes, crocodiles, mosquitoes, Trump flags, and and lake feet. That combo of five
and
is
not a good restaurant
deadly.
Anywhere in sight.
No, all
dude.
Deadly.
Yeah.
Let's go to Arthur. Arturo, what's up?
What's going on, guys? Good morning. Great show going on.
Thanks, man.
I'm a former chef and I'm a foodie, so I would think the positive for the coast would be the fresh seafood.
Who? Landry's? Who? Or what is it?
Yeah, where are you getting fresh seafood on the Texas coast anymore?
Well, I used to go to Rockport, and there was the big fisherman.
Yeah, well, I feel like almost all, so few of those restaurants are actually because they've become such big tourist areas, so few of them even have fresh seafood anymore. They're bringing in frozen. The thing is that people are look, it's hard to line catch anything anymore. Mm-hmm. The big fisheries have all been taken over by big corporations, so they're selling directly to grocery chains and stuff like that. It's become hard and hard. The last three times I've been down there, I've even gone to big, I'm not going to throw them under the bus, but you know the big names from Galveston. And I've had some pretty mediocre crap meals too, where I'm just like, oh. And so I don't know what's going on. I'll try to find someplace. St. Louis is, because there's so many fishermen, I might be able to find somebody down there who's pulling stuff right out of the water and bite off them, but
we'll see.
Yeah, that's what I'm thinking. That's what I was talking.
The thing is, off
the road.
Dude,
we got Red Lobster here, man. It's still solid.
I looked at all of my, fishing rigs yesterday, and I was like, should I take them? And then I looked at all the stuff that my wife was bringing, and I'm like, there's not going to be any time for me to go do any fishing. Why am I going to try to bring these? Why am I going to? I'm not. I bet I don't put a single line in the water.
It's not worth it if you can't go for 3 or 4 more hours, you know.
Yeah, so I just passed on that.
Thanks, Arthur. Appreciate you, brother. Let's continue with scaring Matt about the beach. Lala.
Hello, is this the Texas Coastal Hotline?
Yes.
So that alligator thing came from this area, and it's so funny to me. They were like, oh, my God, an alligator on a beach. I'm like, the alligators live literally, like, across the street and sometimes not even that far away. It's like marsh all the way up to the beach. So
it's just scary to see an alligator anywhere outside of Florida.
I think why people are scared is that Have you ever seen these ladies that retire to the Texas beaches that lay out on the coast? It's sometimes difficult to tell their skin from a gator skin, and people are worried that they're not quite sure what it is on the that it's on the beach is what's happening.
Why are you lobbing up a whale watching joke for me?
That has nothing to do with whale watching. It has to do with that boy. Sometimes you get a lady that's down there in Rockport who's been fishing for a long time. She's like, I love turtles, and I'm like, of course you do. Your mom was half turtle, probably. Look at your leathery.
That's why you've lived to be 200.
Yeah, and she's like, and I'm like, and I'm supposed to believe that your hair is really that blonde? I love Pall Malls. You know what I mean? Don't give me the ones with the filters that blocks the. What's that?
That's who she named her kid after, Paul.
Paul. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Lala.
Thanks,
good
Lala.
To hear from you.
Appreciate it. We got time for one more.
Why are we going to the coast?
I'm asking you that, and luckily I'm feeling vindicated.
I'd like to go with you guys.
Caller, what's up?
Hey, guys. Good morning, I just got back from the Bahamas. Chewy, man. The beaches there were wonderful.
Really? As good as Rockport?
Oh, man, I grew up in South Houston, Matt, so I grew up on those Galveston, San Leon, Crystal Beach,
yep.
all the garbage beaches.
God damn it, dude, come on, man.
We can sit there and enjoy the view of the nice giant ship channel ships driving by.
Yeah.
Look at that, amazing.
Look at that, what just washed ashore.
Look, kids, capitalism.
Is that a McDonald's cup?
So I'm on St. Thomas 2 weeks ago. I'm at St. Thomas. I go down underwater, and me and my wife are cruising along the beach. There's a group of about five people in a 10-foot circle. I come up, and I look down, and there's a giant stingray, probably 5 foot, ooh, 6 foot long,
no,
with
sir.
Tail.
Yeah.
Like, dude, it was huge. I popped up and said, do y'all know there's a giant stingray between y'all? They had no clue. No clue. And they stepped on that sucker, and who knows what would have happened.
I would have punched it for Steve.
As soon as they all started scurrying away, I popped under and it turned around and it bolted out of there, dude. That was a fast moving fish. Like, that was like, that's like shark speed and stuff. It was moving real quick.
Oh, see, no, sir. Even the dope beaches, I don't know about. But I want to save up and go somewhere like that.
And yes, there was sand dollars. We brought back a big old sand dollar.
Okay, sir.
You got to steal them from their beaches because I've never seen those in Galveston.
Well, let me ask you a question, sir. Well, with your big fancy look at me going to Bermuda, let me ask you a question.
Oh, whatever. Don't even start me with Bob. Bob's going to Hawaii. That's where I grew up 4 years for a while, man.
No, I don't have any plans to go to Hawaii, but let's go.
And let me ask you
a question.
Dogging on the beach that I'm headed to, were you able to buy any crystal meth within 15 feet of where you were staying?
Oh, definitely. There was all kinds of stuff you probably could have found.
Maybe the Bahamas is a good place.
Part. The cruise ship pulls in, and it's like you pull into the poorest part of the island, and you have to tromp through all the people peddling and selling and everything to get to any of the other nice stuff.
Yeah. I'm sorry you had to see poor people, sir. Sorry that happened to you.
All right, thanks, man.
Right,
you
thank
convinced
you, man.
Me. I'm
going to
go somewhere dope like that soon. Mm-hmm. Maybe this year.
Good luck, Matt.
Yeah, have fun.
Scott really got me down all of a sudden. Because I'm not even down about the beach. I'm just starting to think about how much money we were spending on this trip.
And it's a short drive. Don't worry about it.
I don't even worry.
Buy two windows, get two for free, plus zero down, zero interest,
that's
zero payment.
Safe.
Welcome to Tech Yourself Before You Wreck Yourself.
All right, Mornings with Matt and Bob, powered by Chewy. The show goes on, it continues, and we get into our, what did we call this segment? Tech Yourself or Wreck Yourself?
Wait, are you bringing back Tech Yourself or Wreck? I thought that
we got
was
a robot.
One day.
Remember Robot 69? We got
Tech Yourself Before You Wreck Yourself.
Yeah, we got Robot 69, our newest cast member who helps us with the stories. I've got a story. I think Chewie's got a story.
He's a pervert
in
too,
the tank. Tech Yourself Before You Wreck Yourself. A big thing around the world these days, and certainly happening here in New York City, in our country. And I don't know if Austin, I know in Vegas I see a lot of these things, but they're called kiosks, these digital kiosks that are going up everywhere. They may show you a map or show you advertisement, flat screens in the middle of a sidewalk that go up, 10 feet in the air or whatever that have beautiful ads on them or maybe give you directions to where you're going. Maybe some of them are interactive. In New York, there are something like 1,700 Wi-Fi kiosks now that have gone up on sidewalks. So there's these monolithic type of kiosks. They're not manned by anyone. They're all automatic where you can stand next to it and get a good Wi-Fi signal to make calls or do whatever you do with Wi-Fi. Only problem is...
What is that problem?
These all have all kinds of mechanisms to grab information from you. Just mm-hmm. even if you're just walking by and not directly interacting
yeah,
with it.
Yeah, I'd imagine that to be true.
So it can grab all kinds of... I don't know if it could... I would imagine they could train it to get your credit card information.
Oh, yeah.
But certainly stuff from your phone... all your information.
Mm-hmm.
And so no one seems to care. Do we care? We can't put the bunny back in the box, can we? Would you ask robot number 69 if...
What do you want
to
ask?
I don't know. I just
want
to hear his voice. I don't care what he says. I don't.
You don't care? Shouldn't we just write out an entire script for it to just read then if you...
Good question, Bob.
Script. It processes and gives you a response. Although it might be slightly perverted, it's going to be a good response.
Okay.
So, yeah, let's...
Hi, Bob.
Yeah, he says hello.
Oh. Hi. Do we have anything like this in Austin yet, downtown? Any kind of information kiosk, Wi-Fi kiosk that can farm... harvest all this material,
sure.
you know, information
I mean,
off
look,
of
we
us.
We live in a tech city, which means that they, whenever they come out with one of these new technologies,
mm-hmm.
we're the guinea pigs they try it on first, right?
Yeah.
Isn't this the city where, I mean,
yeah.
When they have a new dating app, they try it out in Austin first before they expand
it nationally. They used to test market a lot of movies here before they were released. Things like that. So, yeah, I would imagine. But I don't think anybody cares anymore. That seems even scarier.
Yeah, it is, isn't it?
Right.
But what are you gonna do?
I'm gonna scan your phone.
I mean, I think there's protection, like your bank has protection and stuff. Are you worried about robots?
Oh yeah, my
stealing?
Wonderful bank.
I saw a woman yesterday.
The same company that charges me $10 for an ATM charge and. Is trying to charge my dad $35 a month while he's in a memory care facility because his balance in his checking account isn't as big as it used to be. Those banks, those wonderful banks.
You're going to start stereotyping robots now. 69.
What does 69 have to say about that?
I steal your innocence, Bob.
I can't understand it.
What is loud
it?
Enough.
Does he? Is there a slightly different robot voice?
No,
or?
It's just, we can only afford this one.
We can
I
only
steal
afford
your innocence, Bob.
Yeah, we can only afford robots.
Your innocence, Bob.
Yeah, we can only afford robots.
Your innocence, Bob.
Unless okay, they really...
I think you're in good shape.
This is the same bank that when I went to them for a home loan, they told me no. I went to a broker, got my loan through a broker, and guess who the broker sold the loan to?
Who?
The bank that wouldn't give me the loan.
Right. That's a story as old as time. Song as old as rhyme. What do you have, Chewy? Did you have something?
Yeah, I got some tech news. If y'all haven't met Ballie yet, have y'all met Ballie?
I don't know Ballie.
Let me introduce you to
a workout robot.
And let me introduce you and 69 to Ballie here.
Samsung has a new robot. This thing is called Ballie, and it's coming out later this year. And before you ask, no, they don't have a pricing yet, but it can do some pretty cool things. It's billed as an AI home assistant, so it kind of rolls around your house and really helps you with some daily tasks. So
like what?
In this demo that we just saw, Samsung showed how Ballie could actually help with exercise routines. So you can set up Ballie.
No
right
one
next
lives
to
in a house like this.
Sit-ups,
right.
Push-ups,
not
whatever,
a rug, not a carpet.
The exercise routine on the wall. That's right. Ballie has basically a little built-in projector, and it can shoot on the wall, and you can also have it switch, let's say you're doing sit-ups in this example, and shoot right up onto the ceiling. Pretty cool. So
no, it's not.
No, it's not. It's a projector. It's a projector with wheels on it.
If you want to have the projector go and show you your appointments, it can show you what's in the oven. It can do a lot of different things.
My phone can do all of these things.
Yeah.
What's the point of the future?
The idea is a lot of devices don't have screens, so if Ballie can interact with them and react to your voice and use AI, it actually allows you to see a screen on a device that normally doesn't have it, like a fridge.
I know how
or
these companies work.
Like
I know how they work.
So Samsung says,
okay, pause. We can't do the Google. We can't do the Google. The Apple glasses. What do we got? We're at Samsung. We're in the boardroom, right?
Right,
guys. We're getting eaten alive by Apple and their Vision Pro. We don't know what to do. We're losing market share. Let's shoot it around the room. Who's got an idea?
Okay, you
Bob,
know
what what's your idea? Hey, what if we have a soccer ball with wheels that we put a projector in? Anybody?
Oh, you mean like those robot butlers from the 1980s? From the Hammaker Slimaker catalog?
Exactly. You see my vision.
I love it. Let's get a cute name. Who wouldn't want to have one of these? They're literally trying to resell me. What's the vacuum, the robot vacuum?
Oh, the iRobot. I still have one.
What's it called, those robots?
It's made by a company called iRobot.
What's the robot vacuum called?
Why can't I think of it? I call mine Steve McLean.
The robot vacuums? What is it called?
Hey, Lynn, what's the robot vacuum called?
Roomba.
See,
we look like idiots.
That's an educated man right there.
Yeah, it is. I thought that's cool. Like, this will be a first step into something cool with a robot.
Nobody has come up with an idea because
it is a projector in a ball.
Do you know why the iPhone space so you can plug your headphones in and listen to music?
Right.
Even though we already have MP3 players. That's all they did. They just took things that were there. The reason Apple, and now everybody that's followed in suit, freaked the world out is that when they first showed it, people, it went up on the screen and people go, what is that?
Yeah.
Nobody knew it was a phone.
They didn't
because
know how to interact with
there
it.
There were
just
no buttons.
Glass.
And then it opened up and they said, everything is touchscreen. And we are all like, what are you talking
are you kidding
about right
me?
Now? And then they were like, it's a phone, but then when you push one of these buttons, now it's a calculator. When you push this button, now
and
it's
here's
a...
And here's the deal. It doesn't hold 25 songs. It holds 10,000 songs.
Right now, they're showing you this Roomba thing and saying...
Which, by the way, is in a laboratory, fake living room with no carpet, no rugs. Who lives like that?
And they said, and the examples of what it can do for you is it can show you TV on the wall. Okay, guess what else can do that? My TV.
Yeah.
My TV is right there in
he
my living room.
He was projecting it right next to his TV while he was doing sit-ups. Chewy? Your tech story is a fail, and I'm going to program Robot 69 to spank you after the show.
No, whatever. I think it's cool. I think it's something
actually
cool.
What would you do with that if you had it in your house?
What else does it do?
It costs $1,000. What do you do?
It would keep track of everything that I'm doing. Remind me. Roll up
can
next
it bring
to
me a
remind
drink?
Remind me. Say, hey, you forgot to do this thing today.
Do you know that literally right now you can set reminders on your phone, and your phone will remind you of
things
you
forgot to do? Yeah, my wife does that.
I think
she follows me around the house reminding me. Take the trash out.
Yeah, why don't you get a wife?
I think number 69 thinks it's cool, too. What did you think, 69?
I'd suck the microchips out of the thing.
Damn, 69.
You know what it's saying because you're typing it in? No, Bob, what did that say?
Something about 69. I don't know.
We got calls. Let's go to Daddy Funk.
What's up, Funk Daddy?
Hey, since when did y'all start going on the air after 10?
We forgot to break.
Since last Friday.
We just keep going. We keep the fun going.
We just go until we feel like
until
it.
Until we feel like we're out of
Funk
material,
Daddy.
But we're doing all the tech stuff.
Are we bothering you?
No, I just figured y'all must be exhausted by now.
We are.
It's what we do for
we
our
do it
crack,
for y'all.
Though.
Here's literally what happened. They came to us and they said, the ratings are on fire. Stay later. Not like, hey, congrats or way to go. Or, we're proud of you. They were just like, stay a little later. So... There you go.
I love it. I love you guys.
Yeah, we're sorry. We know some people are like, God damn it, they're still talking. And I want to hear.
Shut up.
I want to hear some Johnny Law being played right now.
Sweet Home Alabama. Thank
Just
you,
chill.
Funk
you'll
Daddy.
Get your music. You'll get your music
93.7.
Have a good
more
one, brother.
Talk, less
let's
rock.
Let's go to this phone call as well. Caller.
Hello.
Hello.
Hey, morning. Hey, about the hats with the pump on.
With the little fuzzy ball on top.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I think naval submarine crew, they would put those on for their hats.
So they wouldn't bang their head?
Right, yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, that's what I heard.
Like a little warning device? I don't know if I've ever seen a naval guy wear a... I got to ask
cat whiskers.
My friend Randy
maybe
about
like
that.
Old
yeah.
times.
Well, you know? Yeah, no, I mean, I know they have those weird balls on their heads. Like the Russian soldiers love to have balls on their heads
they
and
do,
their
don't
faces.
They?
Ah, take that,
yeah,
commies.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Got
Got him.
Connie Scums.
Yeah. All right.
All right. Thanks, brother. Right.
Thanks. Thanks for calling. You're in the tech section with the worst phone ever.
You started to sound like 69.
You know what? That Samsung robot makes their ice makers look good in comparison.
That really was a lame robot, because when you said, oh, there's a new robot, the fact that it's...
I thought mixed drinks were going to come out of that slot or something.
It can monitor your pets and tell you when your pets are doing something bad.
It's literally just everything we ever... There's nothing different except it's what we already have in our house, except they put it on wheels.
Whatever, bro. Y'all stay in 1970, then. Caller.
Hello, guys. Is this me?
Hi, Kathy.
Hi, Kathy.
Listen, speaking of tech, station has blacked out 3 times in the last, 15 minutes.
So. That'll do that.
We're that good.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And the other thing is, could I go back to the poker game? Chewy, at your house?
She wants to play
the poker game?
With you.
Yeah, I mean, yeah. Are you you got money?
Are you a big cat?
I am not
cat?
A poker player or anything, but I just have a solution for your problem.
Okay.
See?
Remember, the poker's in the rear. There's liquor in the front.
Bob, you need a job during this poker game.
Okay.
You can cook.
Yeah.
You are a great cook.
No,
you're
Matt's
a
good
chef,
cook.
And
too.
You like doing it. So.
Yeah.
Just go to the poker game. Chewy, you pay him for being the caterer.
Yeah, we can take a break.
Yeah, he can handle the whole thing.
I take 1%. Yeah. I'll take 5% of the pot.
Wearing only an apron, nothing else.
Now you're talking.
Now Kathy's coming.
Yeah.
Now you're talking.
Hey, Kathy, speaking of technology, I keep seeing these ads for this new cat litter that tells you if your cat's sick.
Yeah.
Oh, it turns colors, right?
Yeah.
Well,
so that's got to be coming for humans, right? Something you can put in your toilet.
Yeah, I think you can just taste it and tell.
It's got to be something you can put in your toilet water now that will...
She doesn't need that.
I'm too old for that.
There is something you can put in your toilet water that will let you know if you're sick. It's called diarrhea.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And how many times does a cat get a urine infection? Yeah,
oh,
diarrhea.
Yeah.
All right. Thank you, Kathy.
All right, Kathy.
Love you guys.
Love you, too. Dang. I want to take all these calls, but we got to go. Can we go longer and take one more song?
I don't think there's any rules. I don't know.
Do we get extra credit for going longer?
I feel like we're just hitting our stride now.
We're not going to get in trouble for going longer. If you take that 4 minutes out, it'll buy us another 4 minutes.
If I do this.
93.7 KLBJ rocks Austin. At work. All day.
There. Now we can take that out, and we can keep talking.
And we'll go. Caller, you're on the air.
We'll teach him.
What's going on, gentlemen?
What's up, man? How are you?
How are y'all doing today?
Is this John?
Yes, sir.
Now it's John.
Hey,
we were worried about you earlier in the week, and then some guy called, and we thought it was you, but it's some guy named Mike that sounds like he's doing an impression of you.
Why? You think I'm afraid of Tammy coming from AM radio, cutting me down? I heard her last week.
Oh, did you hear Tammy call in afterward? Yeah, you caught some heat, man, a little bit after that, but...
Well, are you?
We're with you.
She
just
can say all she wants.
Hey, don't worry about it. How's your head? How's your head space?
Man, we're doing groovy. It's the Lord's Day this weekend. We're getting ready.
All right,
right on.
Hey, you taking any trips or vacations?
Question. Hang on. Hey,
go ahead.
Let him ask his quick question, and then we'll follow up. What's up, man?
No. I noticed all the advertisement changed to like Colorado. Yeah, I live on the east side.
Huh.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know what happens on the app.
Steal avails or whatever?
Yeah, there must be. They
and
must be doing some national thing or something. They're running through there. Yeah, the advertising for the app is sold differently than from terrestrial. So I don't know, dude.
I am curious about that.
But it's, Denver's lovely this time of year.
Yeah.
I don't know why you're hating on them.
Well, I've got land in Colorado. I support Colorado.
Oh, well.
They're advertising New Mexico. Nobody wants to go to New Mexico. Come on.
I agree with that.
Hey, it's the land
of
the champ.
Are you going to get into a trip or a vacation this year, John? I worry about you and your headspace. Oh, I think you need some relief.
Trip.
Yeah.
Man, I go on a trip. I go camping like every weekend.
Okay, that's nice.
We're going to go out on the boat on Sunday to the Lord's Day and do a little pescadora, a little fishing.
You got land and a boat?
Well, it's a family plot of land.
Okay.
We have cattle up there, and then Just a little John boat, you know, nothing special.
All right.
Just something to get the job done, you know, a little 10 horsepower Mercury.
Hell yeah, baby.
Yeah. I'm going to buy
a little 30-pound trolling motor, and you get the job done, man.
Get it done. Yeah.
Hey, you take that down on a Chattahoochee.
Nah, you're done.
You catching fish in the shadow of the power plant?
Yeah, well, hey, they just opened up that boat ramp.
I know.
So I'm going to have to go. I've been going out to Georgetown, so I live 5 minutes from Decker Lake, so praise the Lord.
All right, buddy. We'll see you around, man.
Yeah.
All right. Thanks for reaching out.
All right.
Make sure you get your ham for your Lord's Day this Sunday before they run out.
Already got mine bone in, baby.
I'm deviling my eggs for the Lord this weekend.
Yeah. Hey, make sure you do a little trick. Make you a little glaze with some brown sugar, some orange juice. Top it off right. Put it on the oven.
Mm-hmm.
Mm. Fantastic.
Yeah. Just don't get it in her hair. Thank you, man. We're coming over.
Sounds good.
Greens. Macaroni and cheese, mashed potatoes.
I hope this time's out.
Spiral cut ham. Who knows if it's. Who cares?
Are we in trouble?
We're never in trouble, Bob.
I think we're good.
We're the best people ever.
Okay.
Come sail away with us and John.